I've heard mixed reviews about August, Osage County, a play written by actually an actor named Tracy Letts. Tracy has done tons of stuff, character actor. I happen not to know him personally, but, you know, you look at his credits and all kind of sitcoms, and he might have done Homeland or Breaking Bad or whatever. And is from Oklahoma, and apparently his parents are both writers, novelists, and maybe a playwright or something. And he writes this this story about these sisters going home after their dad's death. And Meryl Streep plays the mom of this family. And Julia Roberts, the I guess the oldest sister. It is unbelievable.
Really? Good.
It is off the chart unbelievable. And here's what's crazy. It was a play on Broadway.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, you do a show, as you know, Kevin, 8 days a week. And I've done a couple of dramas. It's been a long time. The Lucille Lortel, years and years ago. I used to do Wendy Wasserstein's plays. I don't know if you knew that or not. But I was in that group. Yeah, I did like three of her plays, and I did one of her movies called American Daughter.
What was the big play that she had?
I did Isn't It Romantic.
That wasn't a big one.
Well, it was a big one. It was, but
kidding.
No, but she also did The Heidi Chronicle.
The Heidi Chronicles, yes.
Yeah, I did. I did. Yeah. Now, sometimes I wouldn't be the first guy in, but I'd be the second guy in. I would replace the lead or whatever. But and she was wonderful to me, and she passed away sadly.
Yeah, yeah.
And then her brother was a huge. She had cancer. She had just adopted a child.
Oh. God.
Her brother, who was a hedge fund billionaire, mm-hmm. takes the child in. He dies. Hard to believe.
Wow.
Her brother was one of the guys, a pioneer
now
in thinking
have the
of the
kid?
Hedge fund. I do have the child now.
You have the child now. Well, that's the kind of guy you are.
But what I remember is you know, eight shows a week, especially if you have to show emotion, is very difficult. Mm-hmm. So I'm watching this movie last night, which in a movie's hard too, but I'm sorry I didn't see the play. I don't know who starred in it. And then Margot Martindale, who is this kind of overweight Southern woman that you've seen a million times on television and may even be on some show right now, character actress, she was fantastic. But again, Meryl Streep does some acting that it's almost impossible to imagine that I don't even know if she's nominated.
Yeah.
It's impossible not to give her the Academy Award.
Well, of course she's going to be nominated, and
but it's impossible not to give it to her. It's she's so great.
I know, and there's got to be she's got to be stopped. It's like
Tom
every
Hanks
year
is,
she's
is,
so good. Oh,
Tom Hanks
God.
Is really good. Matthew McConaughey is really good, and these other actors are really good. And then
Julia
Harrelson Roberts
is high 24 hours a day, and he's really good.
Yeah, he's really good too. A True Detective is fun, but for those of you that would not go to see August Osage County, especially Southerners, you will really you'll really get it. It is unbelievable in the twists and the turns and everything else. But man, you look at Meryl
Streep
like and you think.
You really love
man,
it.
I love, and I was told, did someone say, did Colin Quinn say yesterday he didn't like it, or I wouldn't like it, or didn't he say
he
that?
He said that you wouldn't like it because people from the South don't like
Jews writing about the South.
He didn't say that exactly.
No, he's, I said that.
Yeah.
But Tracy Letts is from there, so.
So it's okay what he wrote.
Well, I don't think too many Jews write about the South. I was kidding. But anyway, I mean.
Okay, that was a little awkward. Awkward.
Well, Jewish people from the South. I mean, Randy Newman lived his summers in New Orleans. That's how he became this kind of jazzy, mm-hmm. kind of Dixieland singer. Did you know that? That's how Randy Newman. Yeah, he spent. There was something kooky about his parents or something, and he had to be sent down to Louisiana, and he lived his childhood in the for months a year down in New Orleans, and that's how he became whatever. But and you know, Captain Phillips was very good and all that. But man,
we're not Jewish, and I send my daughter to the Catskills every summer.
Mm-hmm.
So,
well, You don't have to be Southern to like this movie. Christina, you will love it. You'll be glued to the TV. You should watch it with your mother.
Yeah, oh, I think that's a nice bonding experience.
It's a very heavy chick flick. It's really heavy.
Who did you watch? Man, with?
And by the way, it is violent.
Really?
It is vicious. It is hurtful.
Catfight?
It's a number of them.
Yeah.
And Juliette Lewis, the young actress, who is truly
love
nuts
her.
In real life.
I like her.
I love her.
But she was in Cape Fear, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, as a child. She's fabulous.
Great.
And then she's a rock and roll singer, and she's kind of crazy. One of the hardest things for an actor to do when another actor has a long, dramatic monologue, and the other actor is what we call, and I don't say this in a bad way, is chewing the scenery. I mean, literally tearing the building down.
Mm-hmm.
Meryl Streep is tearing the building down in this scene, and Juliette Lewis is so quirky that when she's listening, you can tell that her mind is wandering, and yet when you watch it, she's playing the ditzy sister of the three.
Right.
And I start laughing because, Kevin, imagine you're...
That is so great. That is just...
You're tearing your guts out.
Yeah.
You're tearing your guts out.
Yeah.
And the camera's got me in the corner, and you see me, like, look off.
Right.
And Juliette Lewis, her character, doesn't want to be a part of it.
Well,
she's not very deep. And in real life, I think Juliette Lewis is like that.
Yeah.
And, man... You know, look, I am certainly
good casting.
Oh, my God.
You know? Because she is that, you know. And
oh, my God.
And it works.
The movie jumps off, you know, the screen. And, you know, there are human beings that are actors. And so sometimes when you see quirky stuff, that's them being human. And they're friends of mine that I've acted with, and you're looking at them. Like, if you and I worked together and we really had to do somebody else's work and we're acting, we know each other so well as friends, we would laugh sometimes at our normalcy when we're acting. Do you know what I mean? Don't you think?
Yeah.
We would go, that's really Jay talking, or that's really the way Kevin is in this scene. And so that's I hate to go on and on because it sounds like, you know.
No, but I really look forward to seeing that movie now.
You will love it.
It's on my desk.
And all of you out there will.
And
love
I want to watch it, and I just haven't put it in there yet.
And for the men, Sam Shepard's in it for 10 minutes, Garrett. Oh, but you know what? There are a couple of cool guys in it. And here we go. They take this English guy, Benedict Cumberbatch, who is Sherlock Holmes, who is really good. He plays this Southern guy, and he's doesn't have a big part. He's fabulous. And then Ewan McGregor, is that him? One of my favorite actors.
Yeah.
Is that his name? You say Ewan?
Ewan McGregor.
Garrett, do you know why English actors can do a Southern accent so well? That they hire a lot of English actors to play Southerners? Do you know why?
They're trained?
No. Mm-mm. Oh. No, there's a real reason for it.
Like, I can never get away with a British accent.
They watch American TV?
No. Think about who settled South Carolina and Virginia. Think about it. The British.
Oh, yes, the British did. Tickety-boo, Bob.
So the British came over, and the pirates that worked the coast of the Atlantic off of Beaufort, South Carolina.
That's right.
There are people that live on these, not Channel Islands, they call them. There's a certain term for it. They speak.
Barrier Islands.
Barrier. They speak a British brogue that was brought over by the pirates. I'm not joking. And the people that landed then there was, of course, Massachusetts and all. Jamestown is Virginia, right? And South Carolina. And that whole coast there was English. And so the English came ashore, and they populated, you know, the area. And so when the language is mixed from the weather or from black people or from teachers or whatever, it came out and it became a Southern accent. And so English actors have absolutely no problem with a Southern accent.
So it's just in their genetics that they can...
It's why we have a Southern accent. It started from people with an English accent. It's why it's why in Boston you have that accent. Yeah, that was a kind of a derivation of a British accent. Because when I would...
quite the linguist, Mr. Thomas.
That's right. This guy who passed away was a famous a teacher of accents and stuff in Hollywood, and he used to talk like that. Big, tall guy, and he played Southerners and everything else, but he was one of the biggest teachers. And I had to speak French on Cheers, and I had to go to him. And then I had to do a couple of movies. Also, I had to do the Canadian accent on Cheers, which wasn't French, and I had to go to him for that. And then in a couple of movies, I had to do some accents or whatever. I did a play once about people from Maryland, from Baltimore, Maryland. And I didn't want to sound like this, so I went to him to try and get the Baltimore, the Maryland accent. And this guy would talk to you about how people got their accents. And it was like in Louisiana, they believe that the reason why we might have this kind of Brooklyn accent is the nuns.
I know. You've talked about this before. I find that
hard to believe.
No, I
they
find that down. So it makes so much sense.
It does.
And,
it does.
You know, all the nuns came from, you know, the diocese up here, you know.
Yeah. And remember, as black people would learn English, and then we had Spanish and French, and you had English mixed in, and it's really hot, everybody in New Orleans, black or white, sounds alike. Mm-hmm. So it's like, you know, water, quarter, your mama, where you going? I'm going by my mama's house. I mean, we say stuff like, I went out last night and I made some groceries for my daddy. I mean, you went and went grocery shopping. It's starting to die now.
They had an article yesterday in the paper about the difference between Cajun and Creole.
That's a tough one.
Yeah.
There are no real definitions. There really aren't. They try to have them. Creole, to me, is maybe more islandy. It comes from the French in Haiti. Cajun is really a group of individuals that were driven out of Canada.
But it was more about the food. Is the food much
different? The Cajuns were eating the worst food you can imagine. They were eating possum. They were eating raccoon. They were eating squirrel. And they were eating whatever fish they could catch, an alligator and everything else. But the people in Louisiana, I mean, I guess they were eating that also. But this became the absolute
diet. And then Nutria also, right? Weren't they eating the Nutria?
No, the Nutria didn't come in until after 1970. They were brought in for their fur, and they escaped during... they did. They escaped.
But don't they serve that like in,
No, they don't
no,
serve
No, they did.
Here,
I know they They've did.
They've tried everything. They've tried.
They have
they tried to make it
in
dog food. They tried to make coats out of it. They've done everything. Now you just kill them. You kill every nutrient.
But Chef Paul had them on the menu. I believe he did. Yes. I'm not kidding you, Jay. I'm going to look it up.
I wouldn't feed a prisoner. Nutria.
Well, at one time, prisoners, they wouldn't even, a lobster, that was like, you know, don't.
That's like a roach.
Don't you dare.
The Indians looked at lobster like it was a roach, you know. Let's go to Bob, who was in Ohio. Bob of Ohio.
Dr. Thomas, I would like to ask you how you got rid of your Southern accent. I've got a New Jersey accent that won't quit, and I've been away from there for years.
Well, you just have to practice. I mean, I still have a little bit of it, but we were listening yesterday to the old newscaster, Jessica Savage.
Yeah.
And she had a lisp and some kind, and she would say, York, New York.
Yeah.
She had a weird accent, and she would probably not be an anchor person today with that accent. Only on NPR do they have the poor unfortunates that lisp and that were picked on and beaten up as children and everything else with those weird names.
Yeah, they're on NPR, singing. You know.
Yeah, exactly. But I went to classes. I did. I used to talk with a. I put a pencil in my mouth, and I would read the newspaper out loud, and it makes you pronounce every word. It's something they've taught for years. You put a pencil in your mouth. I don't know if I can still do it.
Now a lot of people that you know tried to do this pencil in your mouth.
Yeah.
exercise. A lot of people have died doing that, but
here it is.
They're not, they weren't meant to be broadcasters.
Well, wait a minute, I'm going to do it. Be quiet.
He's going to
joke. You probably don't want to.
Hold on. I'm going to read it right now. CNN apologizes profusely after airing video of Hillary Clinton laughing by Charlie Spearing. January 27th, 2014, at 6:06 p.m. Okay, now take it out.
Mm-hmm.
CNN apologizes profusely after airing video of Hillary Clinton laughing by Charlie Spearing, January 27th, 2014, at 6:06 p.m. It makes you pronounce, okay?
Yeah. It forces you to do it. Okay.
So you young broadcasters out there, even you...
Yeah.
Every once in a while you need to.
The reason why you have an accent is it's a lazy mouth. You have a lazy mouth.
I'm the only one in my family that doesn't have the New York
accent.
Now,
let's talk for a moment about.
Mine comes and goes.
Let's talk for a moment about when people make fun of athletes, especially black athletes or black people that have a distinct accent, or Italians, mooks who have a distinct accent, or Irish or whatever. It, for some reason, the King's English has always been more respected than any other verbiage in the world. And there are people that it makes them angry.
I think
it's great.
Princes die.
No. Speak. I try to speak the King's English, meaning I pronounce the words. I don't have an English accent. But that's the problem. And as much as you will say that, it's okay to speak whatever language you want to speak in the street, it hurts you getting a job. There's just no doubt about it. And look, years ago, my relatives, first thing my grandfather did, who spoke Italian, he made his 10 children speak perfect English. Perfect. And they did not speak one word of Italian ever. And that's how I was raised. My dad was from Texas. He spoke perfect English. And he
How about when you, you encounter a black guy who's been raised in England, and you hear him speak, and they sound like a professor, I mean, they
can.
Sound educated as hell.
Well, they also sound very gay.
Oh, God, how dare you
come
say
on,
that?
Kevin.
Just because a black person has
English
a British
guy,
accent?
They're not.
You think
but
they're gay?
There's something fruity about them.
Oh, please.
We're going to have Bobby Slayton in here in a few minutes.
Oh,
Bobby
Slayton. I love Bobby Slayton.
He sounds like he swallowed, razor blades, and he talks like that and everything else. We ought to talk to him if he's ever tried to change his speech pattern. So
he has. Now, I worked with him on that.
Because of my
homework. Thanks, Jay.
All right, thank you. Because of my lack of saliva and stuff like that, I really have to enunciate a lot more than I normally have. Let's go to Mark, who's in Louisiana. Yes, Mark, the very funny Bobby Slayton in the studio. Go ahead, Mark of Louisiana.
Hey, how you doing? It's Mark from
Great.
Texas, by the way.
I'm sorry.
Okay. It's all right. Not a problem. Hey, that little furry thing you were talking about, what kind of animal is that? I never heard
nutria.
Of that.
A nutria?
What kind of animal?
Come on.
That?
No, a nutria looks nutria. Like a capybara.
Possum.
No. Yeah, well. No, it's bigger than a possum. It looks like a capybara. It's in the beaver family. And it can get huge. It can get like 2 or 3 feet long. And what it does is it's from South America, I believe, but they may also have a strain of them in Vietnam. They were brought to the South Louisiana, and they were going to be raised for their fur and maybe their meat to be sold as dog meat or whatever. I don't know. And they escaped during some storms, and they are prolific makers.
Are they vicious like a...
No, they're not vicious at all, but they eat the roots of the marsh.
They're great
and
pets.
And they have killed, some people have had them as pets. Sure. I knew a woman that had Nudie the Nutria.
Mm-hmm.
They've killed millions and millions of square miles of marsh in Louisiana. And so you just shoot them on sight. You just kill them.
You said they were going to use them for their fur. Is it the fur that
They did that for a while, and they don't do that anymore. They don't do it anymore. Right. Then they did dog food.
Do you have any? Do you have any Nutria jackets or anything? A Nutria jacket.
When I was a kid, my brother, I went down behind my grandmother's house there in Patterson, Louisiana. My brother had killed an entire Nutria family, the mother, the father, and the three babies, and laid them out on the. On the dock. I'll never forget it. Killed all three. Wow. The whole family. Oh, yeah, it's big. The Nutria. Yeah. It's a bane to the environment.
Hmm.
Mark.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. Mark of Texas. Go ahead. Mark of Texas.
No,
what are we doing? Oh, okay. Now, what is it? All screwed up here. Yes, Mark of, now you're Mark of Louisiana.
Yes, sir, brother. Snowed in, brother.
Yeah. How you doing, brother?
Yeah. We got fucking snow coming down to sleep. I-10 is shut down. Chaffalaya Basin Bridge is shut down.
The Chaffalaya Basin Bridge is shut down by Morgan City?
No, sir, on I-10.
Oh, wait a minute. It's snowing in Louisiana.
Yeah.
Yes, sir, and it's bad because
the
coonasses can't drive in the snow. No,
now let me ask you a question. What is the difference between? I mean, what a Creole and a Cajun are entirely different. How do
Creole
you?
Creole is a Negro, and a Cajun is a white man living in the bayou.
That's the way I was raised. A Creole, or they're mixed race. They're of Spanish, black, or whatever.
Yep.
And a Cajun is an original, a high yellow is what they were called, which is an insult. But a Cajun
what is a high yellow, Jake?
That's, I don't know.
Randy Newman? Randy Newman just fucking scored a Blue Cross fucking ad for Louisiana, and it's on AM radio playing 29,000 times a fucking day. From
he scored a Blue Shield.
Subscribed into that contract.
I think they paid him 10 grand. They can run it as much as they want to.
I know, they run it like a motherfucker. I hate hearing it. Listen to 870 out of New Orleans, you know?
Now, when you were a kid, did you eat possum, and did you eat muskrat, or did you eat, what did you eat when you were a kid?
We ate Popeye's fried chicken, actually.
What is it?
Popeye's fried chicken?
Popeye's fried chicken.
Oh. Yeah. Oh, that's good. All right, thank you, Mark, very much.
All right, brother.
Thank you. Let's go to Tony of New York. Yes, Tony, go ahead.
Hey, Jay, I just wanted to talk about the Nutria. I don't want to hold you up on that subject too much more, but, they're muskrat, and not only are they in Louisiana, but they're out west. They were introduced in, mountain men in the Colorado Rockies used to trade them for pelts. They were,
I've never heard them called a muskrat. Maybe they are, but I've never heard them called that. No.
Nutria and muskrats, and they have such a huge, some place in Ohio that they're allowed to shoot them on site. They're such a nuisance. And
they tear everything up. It's absolutely awful.
But you know what the crazy thing is? It's kind of going to gross you out, man, but people eat them.
Well.
Right, rat.
Yeah, it is like a rat, but there are also lots of people that eat rat and think it tastes good. I mean, I just read an article about Cambodia, and the guy went back into the villages way back in the country itself, and he was served quite a bit of rat, and he said it tasted good. He liked it. He was surprised. I mean, it's not a city rat. It's like we have rats here in California, but they're fruit rats. They're tree rats. They're huge and ugly, but they're not the bubonic plague.
New York City, subway rats.
Those rats in New York, Kevin.
I saw
one. Vicious.
Kate and I were in the subway the other day.
They don't bother you.
We saw one that was as big as a cat. It was big as a cat.
Yeah. They're usually
by
the tracks.
They bite people.
Yeah, but if you go up to them, I'm sure they'll bite you, but you stay as far away from as possible.
I know.
Yeah.
Oh, it's great.
But you know what?
They got to live somewhere.
No, but they have the flea that carries the plague and everything. They're bad.
You know, the squirrels out in the desert now are carrying that the plague. Out in the desert.
Squirrels in the desert?
Yes, out where you are.
Nice.
Yeah.
Tasty. Right. Tasty. I think I'm going to go have some fried chicken for dinner. Have a good day.
Yum. Have fun.
Now, that headline I read you, Garrett, let's run it really fast. CNN runs a clip of Hillary Clinton talking about Benghazi, which is the where the ambassador was killed and a couple other folks. And, of course, it's mostly Republicans doing this. But we didn't send the troops in fast enough, and we should have known that 9/11, 10 years later, was going to be celebrated by them blowing up the embassy and all that kind of shit. Of course, we don't know anything because we can't infiltrate.
And there was that movie, too, that movie that incited all everybody. But it has nothing to do with it. Remember that whole thing? It was because of the movie? It was the video?
CNN runs a clip, and it's about Benghazi, and Hillary says, I'm very sorry about that. And then they edit a clip, and she's asked about being the president, and she laughs. But you don't really notice it. It's odd. CNN is so nervous, so fucking nervous, that they go through this big apology, and they make you notice the mistake. Can you run it, Garrett? Do you have it?
The East and spoke Arabic. And
what are your plans for 2016? Sorry. You know I had to ask.
Yeah, you did. You did. I understand. And I have to say, I don't know. Not a very satisfactory answer, I know. But, you know, what I have said and what I will keep saying, although I don't think I'm getting through very effectively, is that, you know, we have a lot of issues right now that need to be dealt with.
This was today?
We need to get, and I was very pleased that we got a budget agreement, for example.
Well, you heard the laugh, right?
I'm hoping that we get past this next
debt. Did you notice anything?
You know, challenge.
There was a cut.
Because I know how the rest of the world watches us.
But it was still part of the...
Watch.
I want to be real clear here. Those are two separate sound bites that we tried to get to as quickly as possible. We call them tape turns. One of them was about Benghazi, and another that was completely separate and a different time was about her thoughts about 2016. It was brought in while she was laughing about something completely unrelated at a different time. That is our mistake. She was not laughing. Let's be very clear that the Secretary of State was not laughing about the previous comments about Benghazi. That was just a quick butt thought, we call it.
That was a while ago, though, wasn't it?
But there you have it.
I don't know, but thanks so much for watching. But here's the weird thing.
What is it called? A butt what?
Who knows? Here's the weird thing. It was obvious that it was two different things, and you didn't notice it. I watched it, and I didn't notice it.
I noticed there was a cut.
But the apology was totally unnecessary.
Yeah, the apology
It's the fear of CNN. CNN is motivated by fear. It is the most they're just scared 24 hours a day of anything. It's the weirdest
thing. President.
Hillary. Yeah, but you know, it's almost like if you know you've done something, if you're sorry you brought it up. Why did I mention that? No one would have noticed it, right? That's exactly what it was. You could watch that clip 50 times, and you don't think she's laughing about Benghazi. Now she was speaking directly to conservatives, not to any liberals. I'll have a lot of trouble if she runs because I don't like her at all. Not even a little bit. I don't like her at all. I'm not that she's not smart and maybe she could be the president or whatever. I just read too many kind of mean, you know.
I think it would be kind of
self-serving
to have her. She's certainly, you know, really smart. You have to agree with you.
Oh, yeah.
She's smart and she could definitely do the job. But I think it would be kind of fun to have Bill Clinton in as... I have no idea what that is.
Bobby Slayton.
The doorbell.
Bobby Slayton is here.
Yeah.
But I think it would be really cool to have Bill Clinton as, you know, just hosting parties. Hosting parties, man. I'm just going over there. I'm taking care of shit.
You see, to me, that is a sham marriage.
It's a sham marriage. I don't.
It is. It's marriage of convenience.
Well,
and they don't talk to each other. They don't live together. They haven't stayed in the same room together. He's out there getting his dick sucked all over the world.
I think they are together.
Oh, please. Why would he change? Why would he change?
Well, that's just the arrangement they have. You know,
he didn't change in the fucking White House.
No. And
he was the president. And his pants were down, and he's jizzing on an intern.
Look at the relationship I have with Marianne.
Which, by the way, I don't care about. That I don't care about. My wife would have left me. Christina would have left her boyfriend. Your wife would have left you. Mm-hmm. Whatever. That's what Hillary should have done, and she could have still been the senator, still been the secretary of state, and still run for president. But she didn't because she was afraid she would lose her place.
I don't know why she didn't, you know, and I don't think you know why. Either. You know, I think that you're just speculating on that.
Self-fucking-serving. You know? Self-fucking-serving.
Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know.
All right. I hope somebody worthy
in
the Democratic Party or a good Republican who, sadly, a Chris Christie type of Republican, but maybe not him, somebody who stops all the ridiculousness about, you know, abortion and gun rights and all the stupidity they're talking about all the time. I hope there's somebody worthy to vote for. But you're right. I think if Hillary runs, I think lots of women will cross over and vote for her. Lots of them.
You know, but somebody else might come up and take her thunder away. I mean, you know, there's somebody out there, you know, that might be
able
to do that.
Well, take two calls, Garrett, take a break, and then come back with Bobby. Freddie of New York. Yes, Freddie, go ahead.
Hey, Jay, listen, everyone's got to get this horseshit idea out of their heads that Benghazi was a organized protest over a movie. It was an organized terrorist attack. I want to ask you a question. Have you seen that movie? Has Kevin seen that movie? One person that's ever seen that movie.
Well, wait a minute. Hold on one second. Also, the book that they put the death threat out over Salman Rushdie, no one in the Middle East that put the death threat out ever read the book. So you don't have to read the book, or they just go, they made fun of us in a cartoon, or there's something in the movie. Nobody has to see the movie. They just speak from the pulpit, and they say, there's a movie out.
So what you're saying is an organized protest with a bunch of people with sticks and rocks that are organized within a couple hours of this movie comes out can take over an American embassy. Bullshit.
I don't know what happened, or, okay, let's say it was a planned attack. We shouldn't be there. There's no reason for us to be there. And,
I agree with you.
And we are not allowed to have troops land in a sovereign country. But they,
when has that ever stopped us?
Well, it does now. It does. We cannot have 5,000 troops land in a sovereign country. And I'll tell you something else. Had our troops started firing on those guys, look at Somalia, Black Hawk Down. Just take a look at that. We had helicopters, rockets. We had green berets, everything. They killed every fucking one of them. Every one of them. It would be like if someone attacked your neighborhood right now. Right now. And so we think it's something where the Americans land and, everybody's fucking scared of us. They stopped being scared of us a long time ago. They're not scared of us at all.
Hey, Jay, I'll let you know. I hope you can spit soon. Later.
All right.
Didn't the New York Times come out with an article about the whole Benghazi thing and how it actually went down and the video was a big part of it? And it was this big.
They don't know anything because we can't infiltrate.
No, that's what I'm saying. The New York Times did this like 6-month investigation.
Yeah, but that's the New York Times, and no one's ever going to believe them. They're going to say it's left wing. The thing is that we can't infiltrate. Look, we infiltrated the Germans. We had North and South Korea. We infiltrated North Korea. We had spies. We had Vietnamese spies. We don't have any spies on the other side. Because they're family and they're tribal and they know everybody. And so the CIA and all that shit is, I mean, Condoleezza Rice knew all about Russia. She was the Secretary of State, right? That's all she knew about was Russia. We had spies in Russia. We've had spies in the Balkans. We've had them everywhere. We don't have any spies in the Middle East. We don't. Maybe some higher ups or ambassadors or whatever, but we don't get any underground information from Al-Qaeda. Look how hard it was to catch Osama bin Laden. It's a mess. And by the way, let them kill each other. Fuck them. What are we worried about? They'll figure it out. They'll figure it out. We'll drop some blue jeans and some fucking PlayStations. Yeah. All we need. All right, Bobby Slayton, the Pitbull. He'll be here next. There we go.
Jay Thomas. Jay. Yeah, little thing, medically they call pussyitis.
Jay Thomas in Indies. Sirius XM 104.
By the way, call our voice box, 347-6-SIRIUS, in any condition that you're in. We will record you, and then we will run you back on the air. And it's especially for drug addicts, drunks, methamphetamine-type folks, boring people, shut-ins, haters, whatever you want. You can speak your mind. No one will interrupt you. Voice box, 347-6-SIRIUS. Jay Thomas Show at Gmail. Also, my website is back up and running with 30 years of my career available for you to see. Movies, television shows, Letterman appearances, everything. JayThomas.com and the JayThomasShow.com. And on demand later today. I don't even know if we have reruns anymore. I have no idea what's going on. Bobby Slayton, .com at Stanford and Sons Comedy Club. Boy, that's close to the other show.
Yeah, it's
in
just
Kansas
great.
City.
Yeah, that's yeah. just great. From New York to Kansas City. How are you, Jay?
Great. And then Jackie's Joke Hunt tonight at 7 o'clock.
It's a big night for me of Sirius XM Radio, yes.
Yes. And then if you go to BobbySlayton.com, you'll see that he's going to be in Brea, California, and, of course, Santa Barbara, California also. Bobby, welcome. We were talking. Some guy called up and said, how do you lose an accent, talking about me and my southern accent?
Right.
Have you ever tried to lose? Were you raised in
Didn't
New
you
York?
Didn't you say that Bobby sounds like he had swallowed razor blades?
Yeah, you sound like you choked on razor blades.
I see.
Yeah.
I didn't realize I had an accent.
You know, where were you raised? Where were you raised? Well, Bayonne?
I'll tell you what's very funny. This is true. You
he
know,
was raised in Scarsdale.
You know what? Yeah, Scarsdale, New York. Actually, the suburbs. But I was born in the Bronx, so I'm actually officially a Bronx guy, Kevin Meaney.
Okay.
But mm-hmm. what's really interesting is that I never thought that my voice sounded like this. And all these comedians, Dana Carvey, Kevin Pollak, guys that me and me to start out with, they were doing these Bobby Slayton impressions. And I never thought I sounded like that. And then a couple of months ago, I'm on the radio in Phoenix, and Frank Caliendo, really good comic impressionist, who lives down there, comes in, and he gets on the mic, and he starts doing me. We're talking back and forth, and I don't really think I sound anything like that. They play it back 15 minutes later, and I didn't know who was me and who was Frank. So I guess I do have a bit of a... But it's, you know, it's funny.
Frank Caliendo does
Bobby Slayton. Yeah, well, he does.
He does a Bobby Slayton.
There's a lot of greats.
Wow.
Yeah, I'm not the only great.
Mm-hmm. Now, wasn't he on Mad TV? His big thing was John Madden, I think.
Yeah, impressive.
Yeah, but he was the NFL made him big.
Yes.
Yeah, he was on exactly. every Sunday for years.
But
doing the NFL.
But you know, this isn't actually what's very funny is it's not so much a New York accent as it is years mm-hmm. of yelling in clubs and smoking because. When I was a kid, I had this kind of high, prepubescent Jay Leno kind of voice. I kind of because my father had taped, you know, always had me taping me and me and my brothers at Christmas time. And my first TV appearance, which is horrendous, Norm Crosby's Comedy Shop, I kind of sounded like that. I kind of had this high kind of, hey, you know, my girlfriend's voice.
Is that where you did the Satch?
No, that came later. That, you thought, no, this was really pre-Satch.
Oh, the Dead End Kids?
Yeah.
He does an impression.
That was the only impression I ever did. And
But everybody who would know what that impression is dead.
Well, what's really interesting, you know, whatever.
Except for Kevin.
Well, what's funny is that New York, when I come back here, I was playing out in Jersey this weekend. And the audience, you know, it's young people, old people. But there's something about East Coast audiences. And New York, tri-state audiences, they're just smarter and hipper. Than most places, just references, pop culture references. Maybe not the kids so much.
No, this is really the area to do stand up comedy. You can't.
Well,
do that
I'll tell you why. You know what?
Right?
I'll tell you why. Out here in California, where I've lived, like half my life, like right now, it's gorgeous. It's really beautiful, and I have a bunch of stuff to do and a bunch of writing to do and all kinds of stuff to do. It's impossible for me to imagine. Not going outside. And so kids surf, kids play volleyball, people are outside all the time. And when you're hanging 10, you're not asking somebody about what they read or whatever. I remember being in a gym in New York, and the two or three toughest guys I've ever seen were talking about an article they read in the New York Times. I'll never forget it. These three kids, college kids. And that's the difference is I think, you know, you find shit to do in New York and there are people that aren't running around, you know, exercising and running outside.
A lot
you
of
know,
guys I mean, in the gym yeah. want to talk to me about my hair.
Yeah, well.
That's at the gauge. Well, but you know what it was, Jay? I mean, I love living in L.A. I mean, you know how freezing it is here in New York now, but it's cold as it is. You know, living in L.A., I'm like
But
that.
Do you ever go outside instead of do your work?
Well, in L.A., I'm always outside. I'm either sitting by my pool or I'm doing stuff. And people, I'm walking my dog in the mountains. But here in New York, when you're walking around, you're walking by places. You're seeing things going on.
That's
there's
right.
a pretzel guy. There's a comic book store. There's a somebody getting shot. There's somebody
a guy
getting,
barbecuing on the corner.
Yeah, a guy barbecuing on the corner. They're underwear. You
know, hello, hello.
You didn't need me here. You have me here.
No, I was just agreeing with you, you know.
Oh, really? You don't think you could replace the gay guy? You don't think you could add to the show? Gay
no, he's...
Who's he talking to? You
now, Bobby, I'm talking to both of you. Now, Bobby, at the bottom of these notes...
Yeah, yeah, wait, this is your idiot producer, Flunky Garrett, wrote this. And Garrett, thing, just tell him what he wrote. I don't know why he put this down.
And I couldn't believe it.
All the places that Bobby, where Bobby's appearing, and then it says, and Jay, he hates Chelsea Handler.
Right. Well, first of all, I don't hate Chelsea Handler. I would nail her in a second. I don't hate her. And but it's all the things that you could possibly have talked about. And I said, you know, I've done a couple of dozen movies. I've been TV shows. Well, everybody knows that. Everybody talks about that. Everybody comes on the radio and talks about movies and TV shows. But, you know, he's trying to make trouble. And, you know, there's a chapter in my book. And the only thing
is your book out?
It's not done yet. Okay. No, I'm waiting to. No, it's a long story, but
I know this book well, is gonna, this is gonna be a great book, Jay.
What's the title chapter? Of your book?
What? No. The book's title called "If You Can't Laugh at Yourself, Make Fun of Other People." My 35 years in showbiz hell, and it has
that's
been
a very long title. Now my book is "The Guy That Knocks the Meatball Off the Christmas Tree," and everybody's been bitching about that title.
Well, by the way, and I was really hoping to show up today. I was kind of hoping John McEnroe would be sitting in for you. I was just hoping.
Fun,
I mean, I think he's got to the point where, you know, they always say when you do comedy, Jay Leno once said to me, somebody can steal your jokes, but they can't do your personality. Jay, I think McEnroe does you as good as you. I think he even adds more color.
He studied.
Yeah, he did.
I you know what's funny, Christina? Have we ever contacted his people or whatever? I want to know
I tried,
how he
yes.
got... What happened?
You can't get a hold of John McEnroe? Are you fucking serious?
What happened?
I sent an email out. I'll have to send a follow-up.
And he wouldn't want to comment on...
Of course, I'm sure he would.
That's insane. Of course, that just...
You've got to see
him. The internet is a large place, Jay. Sometimes you don't wind up getting...
No, but does he have a manager, a lawyer? He's got to have somebody.
He's got to have somebody, like a referee or somebody.
If we wanted to offer him $1 million to do a commercial, we'd have to find him, right?
Yeah,
we'd have
to... Try Patty Smith. No one's trying to contact her.
I'll leave it to Garrett.
Patty Smith, you mean?
His wife.
Smythe.
Patty Smith is the cooler one.
There's a really ugly one, Patty Smith, and he's married to the attractive one, Patty Smith.
Oh, God.
Yeah. No,
well, it's true.
What I was going to tell you about...
Patty Smith looks like a meth addict, you know.
But she's the talented one out of the two. She's really good.
Now, wait a minute. Mm-hmm. How long did you smoke?
Did I... You know what? I smoked...
You never
smoked. I quit smoking probably before I knew you, Meanie. I quit smoking in my early 20s, but what it was...
I met you when you were in your 40s.
Probably. You were in your 20s. I'm a lot older than you. But it wasn't so much smoking, Jay, as the fact that I've never used my vocal cords and my breathing correctly. So I've had nodes. Rod Stewart's had them. A lot of singers have them. I don't know if you've ever had it. Take out of my vocal cords because I never spoke properly. So now my vocal cords are just calloused, is why they sound like this. From years of yelling in comedy clubs. You know, Meany yells because he has to, because nobody listens to him. I yell because I would open up for bands, and I try to be louder than the audience. So a lot of times people are screaming and laughing so hard at my shows that I had to try to stay above the fray. So
And
plus, being gay, he knows how to sing, he uses vocal cords and all that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So
I know how to use my throat, yes.
Yes, of course. And I never did. So that's
You never did, and that's why you have nodes.
Well, I don't have them.
So now you have a beautiful daughter who's on the internet, and she's in some scantily clad shots.
Yeah.
And it's really, you know, it's very sexy and stuff, which makes, you know, even your friends look at that and go, whoa, you know, they all comment. Now, what is that like that your daughter is kind of selling herself through her body?
Well, first of all, she's not. She's got an amazing voice. Not Natasha.
I didn't say she didn't, but I will say that.
I think you're trying to push my buttons, Jay. No,
she's scantily clad on the internet, millions of guys are drooling over that.
Beyonce, you know? Katy Perry. I mean, even going back to any woman in rock and roll. And of course, Janis Joplin showing up for Buffy.
Yeah.
No, but you look at your share. I mean, you look at a lot of female musicians today, and a lot of them, you know, that's part of the whole thing. From Britney Spears to Christina Aguilera, Madonna certainly, you know, uses that whole sex appeal.
Barbra Streisand.
Well, Miley Cyrus. So you're saying it's necessary.
I'm not saying it's necessary. What I'm saying is when you're in a girl band and you're called the Pussycat Dolls, you better look like a Pussycat Doll. Now they're called Girl, G-R-L, because I think the Pussycat Doll.
What about that girl that was on, that won America's Got Talent?
No, they got rid of her, and they
No, and now she has the job. She got the job in the Oh, God.
Yeah, can you think about it?
I'll think about it.
Let me talk to Jay.
Yeah.
I have another cup of tea.
Yeah.
Anyway, so what it was, Jay, I guess the franchise got a little old. They decided Pussycat Dolls, it's enough. And the woman who managed them and had them, Robin Anton, change it into Girl. And now they're managed by Britney Spears' manager. Rudolph was also working with Steven Tyler. And they're in the studio.
Does your daughter still live at home?
No, she moved out she moved out about 8 months ago because she got a deal with RCA Records. But, you know, you get a deal, and I don't think she'd never been out in the real world before, so she doesn't realize that the IRS, takes half your paycheck. And, you know, I said, listen, boy, now that you got a job and a record deal, you have to pay for your car insurance. And when you're single in L.A. under 25 and you decide to shop at Whole Foods, this shit can add up very, very quickly, you know. So was a rude awakening for her. But the band is in the studio with Max Martin, who's the most successful producer in the history of music.
The Pussycat Dolls, that's the name of the
Called Girl, band. G-R-L, and they're recording now. Why am I talking about her when I need to plug my
dumb girl. Hits?
No, I was just asking because, you just think about soldiers masturbating to your daughter. It must be upsetting.
Soldiers? I hope there's a wider range than that.
That's what
more people are masturbating to my daughter.
One by one.
But you know what? You know what, Jay?
By the way, I'm going to give us all something to think about. And for everyone out there as you get older, I don't know what town it was in, but they caught a 79-year-old man. It may have been in Florida.
Masturbating.
In a parking lot of a McDonald's. They caught a 79 years old, and they arrested
him.
Good for him. They should have given him some sort of a sticker, some sort of a star or a gold. You think, Bobby, you'll be masturbating at 79?
Well, yeah. If I could,
I do too.
Well, why would I stop? Why would it not? Maybe not in a McDonald's parking lot.
He was watching a porno, having a McMuffin. I'm not kidding. Some of that Mac cafe coffee and jerking off, and somebody called the cops, but he wasn't bothering anybody. He was parked in the back, and this is what he did in the morning. And he had like a little screen there, probably on his iPad or whatever.
Yeah.
And he apologized.
I bet he was using
and they
the
arrested
McDonald's
him,
Wi-Fi.
And he was nobody said he was embarrassed and everything else. No, he was watching a video. He had brought something.
He was embarrassed to be eating at McDonald's.
Yeah, he was embarrassed that he got caught, but he said he was really wasn't going to show anybody his penis. This is just what he did. He got his breakfast and he jerked off in the parking lot way in the back.
You know,
and I think leave the fucking guy alone. Leave him alone.
Too many people are just finding out who's jerking off. I mean, that's the problem.
Yeah.
You know, Jay, when we were kids, I could see where it'd be
a problem. We need to make pot and jerking off no longer illegal.
You know, with people getting shot in movie theaters and people getting run over by drunks, I think that an old guy jacking off in a parking lot is a lot more. You know, there's a cupcake war going on. Media knows about that. I'm sure he watches that show. Almost love cupcakes. Mm-hmm. But, you know, there's besides global warming and the cupcake war, there's a lot of big issues going on.
What is it? I don't know what that is.
The highest rated food reality show on television, or one of the highest, according to. I just Googled it the other day. People, it's one of those food shows.
Why would you Google that?
Because I turned on the TV and I said, I can't believe there's a show called Cupcake Wars. I didn't go out of my way to look it up.
Well, obviously, you know quite a lot about
these battle. They make a cupcake and one is better or worse than the other.
Yeah.
I don't like the red velvet cupcake because it's all dye. You know,
What do they do episode two? I always wonder, how do you know, when you sell a show, they go, where do you see the program 5 years from now? Well, it'll be, layer cake war. I don't know. But it's like, what do they do the next episode after they fight over the
first
week?
What do they do the next episode?
Well, things evolve, Jay. Like the show Hoarders, when people start hoarding crap and you wonder what they do with it, then they put it in a storage locker and then they have a spinoff show and people fight over shit that people don't want in their house. It's sort of like, Petticoat Junction of the Beverly Hillbillies, kind of little spin-off.
Oh, Green Acres.
Green
Acres came out of Petticoat Junction.
Now, Bobby, you sent a story that either you wanted me to use or you wanted to talk about. You sent this to Christina, and it said from Bobby Slayton about the San Francisco cop caught in the hotel room with the prostitute.
Oh, I said this.
And he was on duty while wearing a cat suit.
Oh,
and he has not been fired from his $160,000 a year job. Well, why did you send this to us?
Oh, I wasn't aware that I did. Can you tell me the story again? So what happened?
In Menlo Park, city council decided not to fire a cop who was caught wearing a cat suit in a hotel with a prostitute, and he's allowed to keep his $160,000.
How did they find him in the hotel room? Was it a bust, you know?
It must have been a bust.
Then, you know, his employees bust him? They come in?
A Motel 6 hotel.
Motel 6? Yeah. Oh, that's dirty.
He was in a cat suit.
He was No, the prostitute was wearing a cat suit.
Oh,
well, that's not the wrong. That's kind of cool.
Yeah.
But you sent this to us.
I did.
Through your website.
I wasn't aware that I sent that to you. Christina, did I send that to you?
The bulldog bite. Yeah. Is that you?
No, I'm the pit bull. What's the bulldog? You're getting all this mixed up.
Christina, it says from Bobby Slayton, it's the bulldog, Christina, not the pit bull.
No, it's the pit bull,
it's
not the bulldog.
The pit bull of comedy.
I'm the pit bull. No. Yes.
Who's the bulldog of comedy?
I don't know, the guy who sent the article.
So, Jeff Dunham?
I don't see the pit bull of comedy here. I don't see it. I see the bulldog.
But I didn't make this.
Police went to the motel to serve the prostitute on a warrant, and the cop happened to be in there as they knocked on the door.
Now let's make prostitution, masturbating in a parking lot, and pot legal. All right? By the way, the people from Vivid Entertainment have a new channel on Sirius XM. We'll talk to them next. Bobby Slayton will stay in our studio as long as he wants to. Go to BobbySlayton.com, Kansas City. He's on the way. Then find out about Brea, California, and, of course, here in Santa Barbara, California, toward the end of February. We'll be right back.
Everything's up today.
I want to talk to Steve Hirsch.
You do? Well, he's coming.
I've hosted. Well, they have.
The Jay Thomas Show.
I got so much feedback saying they loved it. And I'm like, what show are you guys doing?
Jay Thomas.
He's the afternoon guy.
On Indy.
Sirius XM 104.
All right. So Steve Hirsch will call us in a few minutes. Talk about the new Vivid Radio. Now, Bobby Slayton, this is all coincidental. You emceed the very first it is.
Well, they have in Vegas, which is they've been doing it for years in conjunction with a consumer electronics show for years. And you'll have to ask Steve. I think for a good 20, 25 years, you know, the AVN, the Adult Video News Awards, which they, you know, call the Porno Awards, the Academy Awards of Porn. And, you know, it's
how do you not go to that and don't get your dick sucked? How do you MC that and it doesn't happen?
Who says it didn't happen?
Okay.
Well, did I say it didn't happen?
No, I'm just wondering if it was offered to you.
But you're married and you've always been faithful to your lovely wife. So, and you say that on stage.
So it did not actually never happen. But there was one time. That
thank you, Jesus.
It was one time that I came close. I got to say, I was close. It was really, but you know, I Bill Hicks had done the show, and I think Richard Bell's had done the show, and Richard Jenny, and then I went on and I did it once. It's not an easy crowd to perform for because you got a lot of those old coked out spray tan ponytail producers, and then you have all these, you know, self centered beautiful porn stars who are themselves kind of buzzed. So when a comedian comes on halfway through the show, it's a really, really one of the toughest crowds. And I've opened up for a lot of rock bands. But the following year, I hosted it. So I got to go out there when it started. I hosted it like 3 years with a porn star.
More, you know what? It's for me, I'm not a stand-up. I'm a host. It's much more fun to host stuff.
Oh, absolutely.
And when it's quiet, do a few jokes. And then, you know, here's the next whatever. Well, let's go to Steve Hirsch.
Okay, Steve
Hirsch from
David.
By the way, vividradio.com will be Sirius XM radio channel 102. Just opened the Vivid Cabaret there in Manhattan with the world's tallest stripper pole. just in time for the Super Bowl. Steve, welcome back to the show. Bobby Slayton, who has hosted your Vivid
the porno awards,
porn awards and everything else, is here with us along with Kevin Meaney. Steve, welcome back to the show.
Great. Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Now, how many strippers can you fit on a 25-foot pole? They go stack on top of each other?
I think that I saw a picture with four girls on the pole, and I think it's pretty cool because it is the highest stripper pole in New York, so it is a way for us to stand out. But we're excited about the opening of the club. There's going to be 100 girls there. A bunch of Vivid girls are coming to open the club. We'll be broadcasting live. Vivid Radio will be broadcasting live from the club. So it's exciting for us. It's not that often that a new strip club opens in New York, and the location is amazing.
Where is it? It's in Midtown. What building did you take over?
Well, it actually was not previously a strip club. It's at 61 West 37th Street. So what it was a like a DVD or video store that the guys at Rick's, I think they bought the property or leased a long-term lease on the property and turned it into a Vivid Club, spent millions of dollars. I mean, the place really does look cool. So anybody who's hanging out in New York should come by and check it out.
Well, here's a bad term. It says it's going to have its soft opening tomorrow night. I don't think that's a good term.
Not good.
To use
not a good porn word, that's for sure.
Yeah.
No.
But they cut the G-string.
With the official G-string cutting tomorrow, right for the opening of Super Bowl Boulevard. Now, you're here on the show. Garrett Andrews is my producer, and Bobby will probably be in town. Can we score a couple of tickets for them to go into the soft opening? Is that possible?
Absolutely. And it's no longer a soft opening. I am officially declaring that we are going into our hard opening. And that that begins. That
I just got a Google
tomorrow.
Alert.
we have switched over from soft to hard opening. Mm-hmm. The girls are flying in tomorrow. I think they'll be there. I think they'll be there tomorrow night, and off we go.
Hey, Steve, I got a question for you. You know, all the years that I've known you, and I used to do the porn awards. You know how, and Vivid, of course, one of the front runners and most classy of all the adult film video companies. How much, I'm sure you're tired of answering this, and I'm sure it's a pain in the ass, but with all the free porn on the internet, how much has that killed the adult film industry, and how much has it hurt you guys?
Well, it's certainly challenging. There's no doubt about it. And I think what we've seen is that there are fewer companies, and I think going forward we'll see fewer companies, but the ones that are around are going to be stronger. We're going to see fewer movies made, but those movies aren't going to, you know, show up on all of the free sites.
And you're really making beautiful stories. That's what it's all about.
Well, you know, it's funny. I mean, you make a joke about it, but it is funny. It's like
yes, I was making a joke about it, but it's also true. You know that it is you're doing. You're telling
Star Wars. Haven't you redone Star Wars? You've had some big productions.
We've done a bunch of superhero parodies and other big movies. But the industry really is cyclical, and it's gone from where there were stories to where it was what they called gonzo, and then we went through a whole amateur phase, and now people are again interested in stories. We especially see that on Vivid TV, which is our TV network that we launched in the last year. We have over
what would you do with August homes. Osage County? How about that?
I don't know, that would be a tough one. I'm not sure.
Well, that would be a lesbian thing. It's all women in that thing. Now let's look at the lineup over there on 102 on Vivid Radio. Which is it on the air now? Is it happening right now?
We've been up for about 2 months and we're having a great time with it. We actually have 20 different hosts that each
I'm looking
hour.
Like Monday night at 9:00. Tap that Ash with Ash Hollywood. That's a great one.
She really is an amazing host.
Tuesday night, 8:00 on 102, the Mary Carey Happy Hour, reality star, political candidate, and sex goddess Mary Carey gushes with exuberant energy. She'll be
and
on
I
tonight.
I mean gushes.
Mm-hmm. Tuesday, also at 9:00 tonight, Deep Penetration with Kendall Carson. She'll have in-depth interviews with the porn stars. Then at 10 o'clock, Dirtiest Girl in the World tonight.
Ooh,
Annie
my
Cruz.
Daughter and I are going to listen to that one.
Now, they say on this show, you challenge her. To, what do you challenge the Dirtiest Girl in the World to? What do you challenge her?
Well, I mean, you got to listen to the show to believe it.
You've got to give us
really
a tease,
is.
Steve, a little tease.
Well, I mean, like, she, what she does is guys call in, and she, you know, she sees how quickly she can get them, you know, excited. And it's pretty amazing how she does it. And it's not only Annie. We have several girls who sort of do those types of shows, sort of like phone sex shows.
Now, wait a minute. And now, does Sirius allow you to stream any video? I mean, they don't do that except for Howard's show, I think. But because
no,
it's a,
we are exclusively radio, although we may
it's all theater of the things. Of the penis and vagina. It's theater of the vagina, theater of the penis. Wow.
But
Asian porn star Micah Tan hosts Slant. Now that's a little racist to call it.
What?
Slant,
are you serious?
Yeah.
Get out of
she
here.
She indulges in your Asian fetishes.
It's called Slant?
The Slant.
The Slant? Bobby, what is that?
That's her name, not ours.
What's wrong with the slant?
Yeah,
it's like bias.
I think the gook was already taken, so that's what the slant. Yeah. So, you know, and they didn't have a lot of options. The gook, I listen to all the time, it's great. That's more Vietnamese.
That's on the history channel.
Yeah.
But I mean, there's a show every hour. They have, I mean, what a lineup. I mean, it's, you know, Friday nights at 8 o'clock, Diary of a Dominatrix. Aiden Starr will host that.
You should definitely check it out. All the girls have a slightly different show, and some of them talk about celebrity.
Steve, do you have any gay programming?
No, we don't, but it's honestly something that we're looking into.
Well, you should come to the number one gay right here is me. You know, I could really help you out with that.
Well, you know what? If you were to do gay programming,
and Bobby could help me.
Is that like a country station having 2 hours of heavy metal? It's like that's not really what you're programming to. You're programming mostly to
Jay. It's all about sex.
It's about guys putting their penises in women. Yeah. It's about guys.
That's because you guys are all fat.
We have out you. Why don't you? I don't understand it. Why don't you put a idea together and get a show on Out Cue?
Because they only have Frank DeCaro.
And this Cosmo.
No, they don't.
Girls.
They have
girls.
Not anymore.
They have to fill 24 hours a day every single day. Are you kidding? Mm-hmm. 7 days a week. You have shows everywhere. Well, Steve, good luck with the new script club. And all kidding aside, maybe the guys want to go. I'm not a New Yorker. I would certainly come to it. The 25-foot stripper pole, I would love to see. Christina, do you want to go also? Would you like to go to the...
That pole is a playground
for
germs.
Oh, of course. I would love that, yes.
Is it a nude
club?
Were
you ever... Is it nude? All nude? No, you can't be nude, right?
Yeah, you can be
nude. Yeah, why not?
Yeah.
No, you can't be nude.
Sure.
It says cabaret. Cabaret is nude.
Oh, that's
nude.
Different.
Nude is nude.
Can you, Steve, you can't be fully nude in New York, can you?
No. No, not with
you. Got to have a
what
little.
What about in the back room?
Not with. Hey, by the way, you know the experiment rhino, that chain of, you know that chain of strip clubs? We have one in Santa Barbara. How do they make money if they just serve fruit juice? I don't get that.
Well, you know, I think that because it's fully nude, they get guys in there who spend a lot of money. So their overhead is way, way down because they don't have to deal with any of the alcohol costs. Mm-hmm. And they get the guys in there, and the girls get totally nude, and the guys spend a lot of money.
So that would be a great station for media, the gay channel. Fruit juice. That would be a porn gay show. Media, I'm giving that to you. Hello. How about a lot of my fruit juice? Yes. Kevin Beatty sounds disgusting right now.
That's why, you know, you should produce it because it would be perfect.
Isn't that great, Jay?
Yeah.
Well, you know what's funny about Kevin is he's such a new gay that anything that's said, he comments on, he oohs and he ahs. I can't wait till you're just a regular gay.
Regular old queen. He's really close to being an old.
Yeah, I mean, I'm regular gay. I'm talking.
How many more years before I become an old queen?
And I'm not going ooh and ah over anything. And you're going ooh and ah, and it's not even anything you care about. You would vomit to look inside of a woman's vagina. You know what I'm saying? It would puke. Steve Hirsch, thank you very much. Christina, again, whatever info, Garrett, and maybe Kevin.
Keep that
would
need pole to go clean, all right?
Tell the girls, you know, you ought to give a show to that. Is it Bree Olson? She was on here. I thought she was unbelievable.
Or Bree Walker. Bree Walker would be great to be on.
Was it Bree Olson? Huh?
She retired from the
business. Garrett would know.
Oh, she did?
Yeah. After the Charlie Sheen girlfriend thing, she kind of dropped out of.
Oh, all right. Yeah. Who did we have on that was really cute and
Bree
fun?
Walker.
Yeah, that was Bree Olson.
No, it was Bree Olson. Why do you keep saying Bree Walker? Don't say that.
Bree Walker was a, wasn't she a newscaster?
Yes.
Don't say that. The one with no hands?
She has no hands.
Yes.
Yeah, don't say that.
But Bree Olson, super hot, super sexy.
She had lobster hands, yeah.
I'm sure
she used to masturbate her husband with lobster knuckles. Steve, thank you. Steve Hirsch, good luck with 102, the Vivid Channel.
All right, thank you.
When I was a DJ in New York, I'm working, I came in, I guess I worked nights at first.
Mm-hmm.
And she was over at a radio station, and everybody said how beautiful she was.
Yeah.
And I believe she called me one night or something.
Late.
A long, long time ago. No.
On a rotary phone?
Yeah, probably. But somehow we spoke on the phone or whatever, and I forget what it was about or whatever. We're at competing stations. And then a guy came to me and he said, blah, 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 Bree Walker. And he said, yeah, you know, she doesn't have any hands. She was born with these, nubs or whatever. I went, you're kidding. And I had thought about maybe asking her out or whatever. Right. And then she moves to L.A. She's a newscaster. And she was with a guy that had been a sportscaster. What's his name?
Jim Lampley.
Yeah. They were both married. Or whatever, they used to make out backstage, and they had this hot relationship, and it was scandalous. And so they get married, and or maybe she had a boyfriend.
She had already had a kid.
Mm-mm, mm-mm,
no, she mm-mm. did. I think didn't she already have?
No. They went to the doctor. No. Listen to this one, Bobby. Listen to this.
I'm listening.
The doctor says you have a 50-75% chance that your children will be born with no hands and or no feet. And they went ahead and had two kids, and both the kids have her affliction, both of them. Mm-hmm. And she is adamant that that's okay. I'm on Power 106 in L.A., and I said something about it, and I said, I'm sorry, I just don't think that that's cool. And she had her representatives call me or whatever. I hadn't said anything libelous, but she got very upset. And then, of course, they hated each other, and they had this very, very public and horrible divorce where all this horrible shit came out. But you know what? I just don't think if you have something like...
How are the kids doing today?
Who knows? They're big kids. They're 20s, I'm sure. But I'm sure they're doing fine. But, you know, it's like one of those crusades, you know? I made it. I got no hands. Well, I made it too, and my kids aren't, deformed, and it's hard for them. And
I have no brain. My father had no brain. And we're making it. We're getting through.
So, Bobby, I've told you the story about when we met at the Fess Parker Hotel.
Oh God,
Your little girl was a. It's in Santa Barbara.
That was
Fess Parker. Is the largest landowner. Daniel Boone, Davy Crockett, the largest single landowner in Santa Barbara.
Well, I met you before that. I think we had worked together once or something. I think I knew you.
Yeah. But we were just moving there. The house wasn't ready, so we were staying in this hotel. My kids are really little, and your daughter is, how old is your daughter?
Oh, she's 25.
Yeah, my kid's 23 and 20, so they were a couple of years younger. So your wife is just this gorgeous model-looking woman, and you get in the swimming pool with your daughter, and my wife gets into the pool with my two kids, and your wife and I stay in the hot tub. And she turns to me, this gorgeous woman, and says, you don't remember me, do you? And, of course, Bobby, I flip cards. I'm thinking, we're drunk, whatever.
You have to be drunk? Why do we have to be drunk to bang my wife?
To forget her.
Oh, forget her.
Well, how would I forget her?
Right,
I couldn't forget her.
Right.
I would have remembered her.
Right.
And I'm thinking, you know, my God.
I would have been drunk to bang your wife.
Yeah. And I said, I don't, I'm sorry. I don't. She said she worked at a shoe company, right? Espadrille, was that it? Was that
I don't remember. She worked at a few of them.
And the owner of this pretty big company married my ex-girlfriend, who was nutty, a nutty girl. And before they got married, she would go up there sometimes, and I guess she was banging the guy. And I was her boyfriend, and we'd gone to a couple of parties or whatever, but your wife worked for this guy, and she'd met me up at an office party or whatever. But my girlfriend was banging, and I didn't give a shit, you know, I only saw her on the weekends. So, and I was banging people during the week myself. Mm. So we have a horrible breakup, and she was really nuts and fist fighting and nuts and crazy. And she said, yeah, you know, you're lucky you didn't marry her. I said, yeah, I knew that all the whole time. When the boss got married, we decided to buy this lovely sundress for, and my girlfriend had been a model, not tall and beautiful, but like a catalog model, but she was really attractive. And so they bought her this lovely dress and welcomed her into the company's family, and she worked in the office with the husband and all that. And about 3 or 4 months later, the cleaning lady comes out of the closet with the bucket and pulls a dripping wet sundress that the wife had balled it up, thought it was a piece of shit, and threw it in the wash bucket of the office. Remember this, Bobby?
No.
Remember this?
No.
And she said, you are so lucky you didn't marry her. She was a bitch on wheels. And I said, you are absolutely correct. And maybe I came close. I don't know. I would tell her I was going to marry her just so we would keep dating. But, yeah, that's what your wife said to me. And I can't believe I didn't tell you that,
you know,
in the hot tub.
It's
you know,
fun.
You know how 12 years later, you're still nervous, right? You're like, oh, God, thank God I didn't. She's also the one that was banging Bill Murray. And I came into her apartment, and Murray was hiding in the closet. And we had a big fight and everything, and he had been banging, and he was hiding in the closet. And years later, Annie Potts says to me, are you Jay Thomas, the disc jockey? I said, yeah. She says, Bill Murray tells a story about you being completely nuts and him hiding in the closet after he was fucking your girlfriend. And all the blood drained from my fucking face. I wanted to fucking kill Bill Murray that night. You know. Oh, by the way, Bill said, had he opened the closet, all right, I found out that he was in the closet.
Oh,
he said, my God. I was one of them. He said, this guy was like an animal. He was like a fucking animal. And he said he was this crazy disc jockey. And he and the girl he was banging, we were fist fighting in the room because she kept trying to get me to leave. And I said, what's the fuck? When I walked into the building, the doorman says, Mr. Thomas, what are you doing here? I go, I'm going to see my girlfriend. He goes, let me ring up. I go, what's the matter with you? So he rings up. Now, Murray couldn't leave because I would have seen him in the elevator, right? And I knew she knew him, right? Yeah, he was in the closet. I was still embarrassed, like 15 years later.
God, it's so funny.
Wow.
And by the way, you know, I was going to tell you, and I forgot.
Yeah.
But, you know, when Steve Hirsch, before he came on the show from, you know, from Vivid, you were asking me and saying to me, you know, your daughter's so pretty. She's in this bag. She's half naked. When I hosted the Porn Awards the first year, Jenna Jameson was 21 years old, and she had just got the Young Starlet of the Year Award. So she's 21. I'm hosting with her, pretty young girl, and her father is backstage with her. And I said to her father, you know, kind of facetiously, kind of sarcastically, you must be so proud of your daughter. And the guy was beaming like there's no tomorrow. He goes, yeah, I can't believe it. 21. That is something that I might have a hard time with. Not a 60-year-old guy or, you know, the things we were talking about
before. What about Lawrence Fishburne?
What about him?
His daughter
takes
a fist in her ass. She is a star of anal sex.
Right. No, I asked him about that, and he is really proud of her.
Yeah, no, he isn't. Go online, Garrett, and get pictures of her. And she also,
I believe, she only did that one video, though.
Bullshit. She did a whole fucking thing, and she also went online.
You only did that one video. Hey, Leo Harry Oswald, you only killed that one president. It's not that you killed a lot of presidents.
One video.
Yeah. No, she didn't.
Hey, Garrett, you know what?
She's done a lot of anal nitrate.
taking small appliances in your ass that you have to practice for a while before you become really cinematically able to
That's a great defense, Gary. You know, I raped this one woman. I slit one throat and already have the bad guy. And you vilify me.
Yeah. She already regrets it, and she's cautious against the industry.
Yeah.
It says, Montana Fishburne regrets doing porn. Cautions against the industry.
She didn't just do porn. She went online and she sold herself as Lawrence Fishburne's daughter. She shit on him. She said all kind of stuff.
I think that's all off the internet now. You can't find
vicious anal stuff. Yeah. So, and her father, you know, went.
Some people are really
into
that stuff. He did. He doesn't talk to her.
Well,
she says, yeah.
By the way,
must have been a really bad video.
The Quentin Tarantino movie was released. Online by Gawker and by Anonymous.
Oh my God! And
we downloaded it, and we were going to read portions of it. We are not going to do that now. He is suing them, and he's going to win the lawsuit. He's suing them for $1 million, which is nothing. But more than that, if they can prove that by releasing it, the movie is unmakeable, which I think it might be, and that it's ruined it. You talk about a spoiler alert. Quentin Tarantino makes, a profit of $200 million in a movie, right? Yeah. And so he's suing Gawker, and he's suing Anonymous.com. So we are not going to read that.
Who's going to show up?
I know they want to. They like notoriety here and all that, Garrett, but I'd rather not have that kind of notoriety.
But who's Anonymous and Anonymous.com? Do we know?
They're owned by somebody. They'll find them.
They're not.
What do you mean?
Anonymous is.
There's no leader.
Kind of like Bitcoin.
It's just everybody.
Well, there's got to be a place where there's a server, where there's somebody.
That's Anonymous.
You take that down, someone puts a new one up.
Yep.
Really?
Yep. That's the way it works.
Well,
I was anonymous last week.
Nice. Well, you'll be happy to hear that the Disney Channel is introducing its first same-sex couple.
Yay! Bobby, what do you think about that?
That darn cock. What a, it's so cute.
Now, wait a minute. It's part of a sitcom.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, the Disney Channel, who my buddy Frank Pace works
Frank
at,
Pace.
They are really the quintessential, sitcom channel now.
Wow.
And I
guess they have the greatest programming.
Oh, they do.
And, they do.
No, we watch. Yeah, they do. My really daughter good and I little... watch like these amazing programs.
Yeah, I've done a lot. I've done a lot of Disney stuff, Jay. A lot of Disney stuff.
Yeah, but it really is. Have you been a voice of a character in a big movie?
I think of Disney.
I've done a bunch of voices, and don't forget, I was Paulie the Polar Bear. With Demi Lovato on Sunny with a Chance. I was
Sunny with a Chance.
Wow. Hey, it's me, Paulie the Polar Bear. It was just quite a thrill.
Well, let's listen to the first gay couple on the Disney Channel. Comes into this, a typical sitcom. I don't know the name of the sitcom. But, Garrett, what's the name of it? Did it say what the name of it is?
Good Luck, Charlie.
Good Luck, Charlie.
And I think this is its last year.
Yeah.
It's not returning.
Oh. Yeah, they're going off the air because they have gay characters.
So the honeymoon for your play date?
Yay!
Who's coming over?
Taylor. I invited her parents, too.
So we're all having a play date?
Oh, honey, this one is actually going to be fun. I met the mom, Susan. She's really nice.
Oh, I met her. I thought her name was Cheryl.
No, it's Susan.
Are you sure?
Uh-oh. Am I sure that I'm right and you're wrong? Always.
Uh-oh, here they are.
Hi, I'm Susan.
Quiet, please.
Hi! Taylor! Hi, Susan.
Hi.
Amy, this is Taylor's other mom, Cheryl.
Oh, hi.
This is my husband, Bob.
Hey, nice to meet you. Come on in. Come on in.
Taylor has two moms.
Nothing gets past you, Bob.
There you go.
No big deal.
There you go. Taylor has two moms.
Two moms is cool. Two dads is kind of creepy. I mean, it's fine, Kevin. But
they did that show already.
Yeah, but they weren't gay. What was the point of that?
Remember when you were a kid, Jay, and it's parent-teacher night, you're kind of embarrassed. Yep. Your parents come. Now, if your parents are two guys, I mean, it's fine. I think it's great. But that's got
to
be kind of tough.
I usually bring a beard in. If I have to go parent-teacher night, I'll bring,
Well, I've said this to Kevin, and Kevin can say whatever he wants to say, but I have said that the sad thing is that most people will always find two men kissing to be creepy. And they always have a beard, and it's just creepy. Now, I accept it, totally. But it's nothing I want
to look at. It's creepy. You watch porn and you see two women doing it. It's great. My wife's had some hot friends over the years, and I've wished that something would have happened. But I don't think my wife's ever going, hey, you and Steve would be great. I don't think, but it's okay that she does it. And it's okay that, you know.
Well, you don't know what I do.
Whatever topic you like. Your pizza is your own business.
It is my own business. But, I think that you should be on the right side of history. You're trying to be, but then you're also trying to have this other tough guy life, you know?
No, it's not tough guy.
No,
it's fine. Yeah. It's just creepy. It's great, though.
Yeah.
In a creepy way.
Well,
it's great.
We're trying.
You
sound all
like from Duck Dynasty.
we're
the
all
vagina is something precious.
We're all trying to figure
instead
it out.
Instead of a man's ass.
And you know, you gay folk have to just give us, you know, some time. We're trying. Yeah. We're doing everything we can. I mean,
well, start manscaping, okay? At least do that.
Yeah, Garrett.
The Disney Channel has finally, you know, bowed, you know, to the pressure.
I think they're actually on the forefront of you know, gay rights. I think it's fantastic.
But you know what? You noticed, Bobby, they picked two women and not two guys.
And two hot women, yes. Two very pretty women.
Yeah. And the guy in the show is that's the biggest sitcom actor I've ever seen. That guy looks like an ex, you know.
That's Dom DeLuise's son, isn't it?
No. No.
The funny thing is, in real life, he's probably the gay one, you know. So, you know.
But they're still doing the dad is really dumb and the mom's so smart. That's still a
thing. What I said. It's quintessential sitcom.
Oh, yeah. That's the way things are.
But they're so progressive with two mother parents.
Now, Garrett, I'm married a long time, and Bobby's married a long time.
Oh, yeah.
And that really is the dynamic in your home. It really is. I mean, Bobby, you're not the smart one at the house, are you?
You know, it depends what you mean by smart.
Smart ass.
I'm smart. My wife
who
is
who's the one who that gets who, put. Wait a minute.
Who's
who
working?
Gets put down?
No, wait a minute.
Who works?
Who gets put down more in your house?
I do because I can take it. There's no reason to put down my wife because she knows I'm a superior being. I'm a man. So there's no. And I'm smart
enough.
Are you
the only man in the house?
Yes. Well, except me and my daughter.
If shit was said to my wife that is said to me, one, we'd be divorced. Two, she'd be a basket case all the time.
Right.
They say shit to me. You know, my wife says stuff to me, and it's like, all right, you know, and I get up and I do it, or I hear about myself or whatever. And I think most men are like that.
Absolutely.
And
you know what?
So, Garrett, the sitcoms are correct. Those guys that are writing sitcoms are writing, you know, they're writing their lives.
To argue with your wife at home, Jay, doesn't do for much good. You know, unless it's something that's really important, you know.
Yeah.
And there's a few little things that I stand my ground on that I will not let her.
Is that? What do you say?
You want to say? I'll tell you what I say. It's a minor thing, but it's a household thing. It's a domestic thing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I love to cook, and I do the grocery shopping.
That is so
and
gay.
I know. And I don't mind. And I don't mind loading the dishwasher. But every time I do it, my wife goes, "It's not how you load the dishwasher. Are you a fucking idiot?" And I go, "Let me tell you something.
That's right. I'm a cook. I'm a cook, and I don't load the dishwasher.
Yeah, and if you want me to load it, and the other thing I won't do for any reason under any
circumstances. You won't load the dishwasher.
No, I'll do it, but it's not right. Don't you know how to do this? I don't know how to do it. I put the dishes in the
washer.
Any idiot could do this. I go, well, you're an idiot. You do it. I just made dinner. I just bought
there
dinner.
There is a way to put the dishes in.
Yeah.
They're supposed to be in the certain racks and all, but I do the same thing you do.
And I don't want to do it.
You put the knives and forks down or up?
You're a woman. You know how to do it.
No, what do? You put them down?
Down.
The knife down?
That's not it. No, it's the plates.
I want to know. I want to know about the silverware.
You never put a blade or a, spike.
But even a spoon. You put the spoon spoon first.
Grapefruit spoons you put down.
Excuse me one second.
Okay.
Kevin,
all right.
You always want to grab something by its handle.
Good, I like that.
We have washing machines that cost $1,000 a piece because they go 24 hours a day. We have loads and loads of laundry. And
why do you have all that laundry? You wear the same thing
every day.
Because
we have lots of people at the house. We always said we have tons of people at the house.
That's another
and
problem.
So,
yeah, go ahead, sorry.
Now, the dishwasher was
a
General Electric dishwasher or whatever it was. And it probably cost about $600 or $700. And we've had it for 7 years, and it blew up. A guy comes in. And he says, how many loads of dishes do you do? We say the fucking thing runs 2-3 times a day. and he says you got to buy a Miele, this German company.
Oh, yeah.
$1,700 installed.
Yeah, the vacuum cleaner is like $7. We have one of their vacuum cleaners for a fortune.
We have a $600 vacuum cleaner.
Oh, I'd love to be a salesman coming up to your door.
No, you and guys. I'll tell you something.
Unbelievable.
Now, we do so many dishes.
You need. Yeah.
What?
No, go ahead.
We do so many dishes, and it is about the size. Now, in New Orleans, I have two $300 dishwashers or whatever, because we don't do a bunch of dishes. But the thing is that these dishwashers, I don't know how they do it, they clean the dishes better than the way we do them, better than anything else.
They're called Mexicans. Is that what you have? You have two Mexicans?
We have all that. Yeah,
they're great.
But we also, here's the other bucks. One. You can put the dishes in there dirty, and the machine cleans them.
Oh, it's a machine.
That drives me nuts. So my kids go, well, it's so expensive. We just put them in dirty. I go, no, no, rinse them off first. That's the biggest fight we have. Biggest fight.
Mm-hmm.
Next to no lights ever get turned off.
You know, the other thing in my house is I don't know how, and I really don't know how, and I can't make the bed.
I don't either. I can't make the bed either.
I don't see any reason to make
you
it.
You don't.
Because I don't know how to make it.
I don't know how to make the
I don't,
bed.
No, I, if you do,
oh,
if you
that
do,
just makes that me sick.
No, no. If I had to do it correctly.
Garrett, are you good at making the bed?
I don't know how
Garrett.
To make
no,
the
I've
bed.
Had this, big, this argument many times that I don't understand why make the bed when you're just going to
get in it a few hours later.
Yes, thank you.
Well, you want to hear something?
Man, I couldn't live with either of you.
All right, well, let me tell you something.
Yes.
Even if you were a roommate. That would annoy me mm-hmm. if I would walk by your room and your bed was not made.
If you never went in my room.
Exactly. That would really bother me.
Fuck you.
That would, no, fuck
I,
you.
Hold
fuck
it.
You.
I know.
And fuck all of you, all right?
Wait a minute. I know not how to though. Make... I know how to make a bed.
Right.
I just don't know how to make it professionally.
That's what like I meant, Jay. I know how to make it. I'm not retarded. But
my mother actually said to me the other day, when we came out to California years ago, you got so upset then when your father's and I's and we didn't make the bed in the guest room. And I said, I did. And she goes, I couldn't believe you got that upset about that.
Did your mother know you were gay then? Was that the telltale sign?
Yeah, well, they did know, yes. But they never told me.
We all knew in San Francisco you were gay.
Oh, you did not.
I knew before you knew.
Every person that comes on this show and has known you for 30 years.
Yeah, absolutely, Jay.
Says
absolutely
you they knew you were gay. I didn't know you, and I knew you were gay.
No, you thank didn't. You.
And I did. Oh. Everybody knew it.
Who's the butchest guy out there?
So I'm talking to a guy that knows Kevin since high school, and I said, Kevin is really fantastic. And I look at my career, and I look at his, and he can sing, he can dance, and everything else. And I said, you've known him since high school. Why do you think Kevin isn't like, you know, one of the really big entertainers? He said two words. Two words. I said, who? Nathan Lane.
I was going to say,
said,
ho.
You are correct. You are correct.
Oh,
Nathan Lane is your Howard Stern, okay?
Nathan Lane's
Jay.
Why wasn't Jay a big deal in radio, bigger than the biggest?
Yeah.
And people were, Howard Stern, he was there. He was the biggest thing in radio.
Yeah.
Nathan Lane is your Howard Stern. And with that, I'll let us all think of it. Bobby Slayton is in our studio. Go to bobbyslayton.com, Kansas City. He's coming to your town.
Oh, yeah.
And you'll see all the other great cities, Brea, California, and Santa Barbara. And we'll be right back.
All right.
Jay Thomas, yes.
He's the afternoon guy.
Very perky, not like the rest of us.
The Jay Thomas Show. On Indy, Sirius XM 104.
Now, this was the best rock song at the Grammys. I think I read some controversy about this. They thought it wasn't rocky enough, Garrett. I believe. Who is this?
This is the Imagine Dragons. Oh, maybe.
Yeah.
It's...
I'm waking up to action.
Rock?
I believe so.
It's rock and roll. Everything is rock and roll. Bill Haley in the comments is rock and roll. Elvis is rock and roll. Led Zeppelin's rock and roll.
Yeah, they.
Beatles.
You go online, you have Separated at Birth.
Whoa.
Gay for Life. You have Kevin Meaney and you have Nathan Lane. There's a picture of him. That's pretty funny. Have you seen that, Kevin?
No.
Show it to him, Christina.
What?
They have sure. you separated at birth with
Nathan.
Yeah,
you got that on Nathan. Twitter. You didn't see it this morning?
No.
At Elsie or something like that? Here.
Yeah.
Wait, Twitter's down. Hold on, I'll just send it.
Yeah.
I don't get.
There you go.
I don't get the internet access here.
Here, look.
Bobby Slayton's back in our New York studios with Kevin Meaney. Bobby, is he in the
studio?
Who
put that up? He's grabbing coffee.
At X-Server. Right.
Oh, I like that.
So, years ago when I would, I used to go to the Sundance thing and I guess I did some independents and there was a thing called Slam Dance and I went and I would go skiing and all like that and I would go to Sundance. And it was fun and everything else. And then you'd watch the movies and they were so weird. And they would be, and you know, there was the one where Charlize Theron was the hitchhiker, and she killed all the men, and she was a lesbian, and it was
Monster.
Released to the, it was released to the theaters, and she was maybe she even won an Academy Award. It made about $2 million and all that, which I hate. and then there was a guy that ran Sundance, and he was being eliminated by Robert Redford, and he'd run it for a few years, and I think that it was because there were too many gay-themed movies, that he was really picking a lot of gay-themed movies. So I get in the hotel room, turn on the TV, and he's giving a speech, and sure enough, he's obviously gay and everything else, and they're getting rid of him. So they brought some other people in there, and they've made some great things. And Robert Redford's movie, All Is Lost, is from Sundance. Some guy wrote...
Have you seen it?
Agent. Yeah, I didn't get it. I didn't know what that was about. I don't know.
I think it's like a silent movie, right? There's
he was
one
lost.
Word in the
but
whole.
But he doesn't cry. He never cries out of despair. He yells one time. He never curses, and he doesn't talk to himself. And so, consequently, it's silent. And he is 80. He's close to 80 years old. He looks fine, and he moves around the building.
Oh, he looks
and
great,
else.
But he's had some work done.
But he's... No.
Yeah, he's had the eyes done, I think.
Maybe, but his skin's pretty thin. But now, they always get people, and they always have these movies. They've got the Skeleton Twins with Kristen Wiig and Bill Hader, who are incredibly funny. And what do they play? Suicidal brothers and sisters. They're both suicidal, and it's a drama.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want to see that. I don't want to see that. Why? What do I want to go see a movie about suicidal siblings? They overcome comic typecasting with writer-director Craig Johnson's Waldo Salt winning screenplay. Really? Who's going to go see those two? Who would see a movie like that? Why would you see that? You know, here's another one from Sundance. Dear White People won the special jury award. It's about racist parties on Ivy League campuses.
Okay.
Dear White People. Well, I guess so, but
great.
Infinity Polar Bear with Mark Ruffalo. His poignant role as a husband and a father of two young daughters. Infinitely Polar Bear. That's what it is. Yeah, it's like, suicide, I wish commercial stuff, more commercial stuff came out of Sundance. Maybe Brokeback Mountain came out of there. I don't know.
That sucked. Who wants to watch that? Who wants to watch two homos kissing? What kind of movie is that?
Oh.
By the way, that's the movie that
Kevin does.
No, put it down.
Well,
that was a horrible movie.
It was not horrible. It was a great movie.
Did you know about
two guys that loved each other? You know,
but okay. It was,
and things changed after Brokeback Mountain.
Okay,
since Brokeback Mountain,
that was
you
great.
Know we have so many.
It's
more
like the
now.
Movie. It's like the TV show Looking on HBO. I watch. I think HBO does some great stuff. So I got True Detective, and then Looking comes on. And it's all guys, and they're gay, and my son and I are in the kitchen, and we
and
just
you know that
watching.
When you turn it on, you know what you're
right.
You're getting
okay.
into.
You know what you're getting. So we're watching it, and I turned to my son, and I said, now, you know, you're a straight guy, I'm a straight guy. Is there anything in this for us? I mean, Sex and the City actually had stuff that we could watch, or Girls had stuff we
oh,
could
I
watch.
Oh, I bet you would watch that if you were alone.
I'll watch a whole episode of it. There is
absolutely.
Nothing. There is nothing in looking that I can a little bit even attach myself to. It's all gay guys.
Jay,
that's all it is.
Did you like that?
That's all it is.
That movie Brokeback Mountain. Not only was it boring. If that was straight people, it would have sucked. But did that movie?
Yeah.
It sucked. The movie, right? And you know what?
Well, the reason why it sucked was
it sucked
there was
you.
No setup to them making love. It's like you and I go camping, Bobby,
right?
And or whatever we're doing with the sheep,
right?
And before the night's over, we're making out.
Right.
Where'd that come from?
Plus,
where'd
you
it
know
come
what?
From?
It ruined every summer for me at Brokeback Mountain. It became overrun with homos and kids, and it was just a mess. It used to be such a nice little getaway.
Wait a second. Kevin, is there really a Brokeback Mountain, a real place?
I'm sure if there is, I'm sure Bobby knows where it is.
Yeah, I don't go there anymore.
Yeah. Well, you did.
Right.
You know. By the way, Jay, right. I went to Sundance. You know, you're talking about
I go to the Catskills. Okay.
Have you ever been to the Sundance Film Festival?
You
me a lot of times, just talking about it. Yeah. And they have Kristen Wiig, and they have John Hader.
No, right.
Their new
that.
Film
right.
is about suicide siblings. Yeah, I just talked about it.
Right. I just walked in. I was out of the room just to get a cup of coffee there. But I went there once with my daughter, who was in a film at Sundance. And she was about 16, an award-winning film. It got incredible reviews called a nice independent little movie by a woman, Miranda July, called Me and You. And Everyone We Know. And my daughter had been in a lot of a TV show, never been in a film. And Roger Ebert had given it a tremendous review and said the two teenage girls do a bang-up, magnificent job. But there's a scene in the movie where my daughter and this other little girl are, you know, simulating, I can't even say it, you know, because it's so...
Sex?
Yeah, but going down on this guy. And my daughter, and I'm going, I got this, that...
You sure they were simulating it?
Well... It was
a, no, wait a minute.
Yeah,
how did they shoot that? Well, they shot. They just dipped out of the.
They just dipped out of the camera.
It was
a mainstream film, and there was a teacher on the set. I mean, that's maybe how she got the part in the first place.
Hopefully,
there
was a teacher.
But it was
do
really.
Do they just put their head against his leg?
I would not be able to deal with that.
I really was not looking at the screen. It was very. That was hard to watch.
You mean you weren't as proud of her as the guy whose daughter won the Vivid Star of the Year award? The dad backstage at the porno.
Well, I was proud of her because that's not what the whole film was about, and she didn't really do it. And she got great acting accolades because obviously, if anybody knows how to act and fake a blowjob, it's her mother. So I'm sure she learned from her. About how she pulled that off. Her mother's one of the greatest actresses of all time. She acts like a cunt, she acts everything. So, I mean, my wife, I've told her this many times, my wife's acting ability, and a lot of times you don't know my wife's acting because she's so flawless and seamless when she performs. Because, you know, there's a scene in Scarface where Al Pacino drops the accent for a tenth of a second. Somebody pointed out on IMDb how Meryl Streep, maybe for an eighth of a second, drops an accent. But my wife, when she acts like a cunt, her performance is so great, it's Broadway worthy that she doesn't drop the character for any amount of time, and I'm surprised. And I can tell if she keeps acting like a cunt, she's going to get type care. She's going to walk down the street like Bob Denver, and people are going to be screaming at her, "Hey Gilligan, hey Gilligan!" And I'm going to go, "She's not really a cunt. She just plays one on TV." So I'm trying to steer my wife away from that. I said to her, "Maybe you should just take an acting class and improvise. Pretend you're like you're a woman who likes to give head. Why don't you just maybe try a role? That way, as an actress, people go, well, look, she can do a lot of different things. She's not stuck with this one thing, you know."
Yes.
But that's probably where my daughter got her talents from. Yeah. Thank you.
Oh boy.
God. Yeah.
Oh man.
Yeah. Well, it's I'm glad you're laughing, but it's not that funny to me.
And who do we have on the phone right now?
Nobody.
Yeah.
No one.
Oh, you guys.
His wife didn't call in.
We're gonna try and have this guy on if we can, or we'll have it. But SodaStream, which is a company that you know, you spray air into friggin' water and juice, and you make a soda. They get rejected. This is like the third year they got rejected for the Super Bowl. Do you have the song, Garrett? The SodaStream song that they rejected?
I guess Pepsi and Coca-Cola.
What is it that they rejected about it? Is it a song or is it the...
This is what companies do that don't have the money to pay for a Super Bowl ad. They put an ad together and then just say, banned from the Super Bowl, and everyone picks it up and plays it.
Is it only because it's not worth running? Is it only because at the end of it they say Pepsi and Coke, watch out, here we come, and they won't run that? Is that it?
No, I mean, Coke takes shots at Pepsi in their Super Bowl ads.
They're saying that Fox rejected this Super Bowl ad because they're afraid of Coke and Pepsi. That's what it says here. They've rejected it.
It's 3 minutes and 46 seconds long, too.
Oh, well, and they have Scarlett Johansson in it. So they've rejected it. Is this it?
Yeah.
Turn it up again.
What is that noise?
That is the new neighbor. He's like a country singer or something.
How lucky for you.
You should see his truck.
That rusty thing parked in front of the house.
Can't miss it.
Is this Soda Stream?
It's like 100 years old. I thought that was like the gardeners or something. Where is he from?
The PBR thing?
Probably like Kentucky or Fresno.
Yeah.
What's his name?
Scuzz Twitty.
Get this. It says Scuzz on the back of his truck. For real.
But this is for SodaStream?
Scuzz Twitley in big old shiny letters.
Oh, this is what I was saying.
G. Hello, Beverly Hillbilly.
These women are terrible. I wouldn't want to because of them.
I like the foot.
You can spit on my pickup truck, call my ma a lousy whore. Leave a flaming bag of dog shit. Trailer door.
I think this
is
nothing
to do
with
this.
No, this is nothing. My mistake.
Go for a Soda Stream right now.
I like this song.
Jared, I just sent you
my PBR. We screwed. I like the song, though. What is this for? Pabst Blue Ribbon?
Yeah. My little sister, like a drum in the big parade. You can hand me a big old cup of piss and tell me it's a lemonade.
This was also rejected, this ad.
Rattlesnake in my grandma's cookie jar. Keep your hands off my PBR.
For Pabst Blue Ribbon.
Oh, is that what it's for? Pabst Blue Ribbon. Okay.
Sounds like the Christian Mingles.
Like no, it's a Pabst Blue Ribbon commercial that they've rejected.
All right, now I have the real commercial.
Oh, but I don't think the soda thing is worth it. It's just that they warn Pepsi and Coke that they're coming after them or some nonsense. First of all, it's terrible. Why you have a machine and you blow air in it and you put some juice in it?
My ex-wife and Kate have it.
We're going to talk to him soon, so let's wait until we.
And I actually got
the only thing it is.
How terrible everything is.
But I think Coke and Pepsi sell the syrup for it. I thought you could get Coke.
No, I don't think that because they're more natural.
It all tastes the same. It's
horrible.
No.
At Christmas time.
Never going to get him now. Can everybody shut up, please?
No. At Christmas time. People get all kinds of shit. They get we have a thing where the ice is in a ball. We got that for Christmas.
Yeah.
You get a slow cooker that you end up, using twice or whatever. And you get like the thing that makes soda with the.
How about a panini maker? Do you get a fucking panini
all of that?
Maker?
Yeah. You throw that
fat
shit.
Fat people with their panini maker.
I got your panini maker. I make paninis all the time.
But it takes up half your calendar.
Yeah.
There are two vaginal flatulence stories that are out there.
Yes. I sent you one yesterday.
Right, but there's one before it. A 13-year-old male high school student was teaching an 18-year-old girl, was teasing her about her vaginal flatulence before she struck him in the testicles, and he called the police near Pittsburgh. But you know how he heard her vaginal flatulence?
How?
She was getting laid in the back of the school bus. And her vagina was queefing.
Oh, my God.
What a... Garrett, go to...
I got it.
Oh, God.
It's a true story.
Oh, thank God my daughter doesn't take the bus.
The accused expelled wind from the vulva during coitus while at the back of the school bus. What, by the way, what sort of horrible people?
Sex.
Why is it
intercourse?
Sex? That's what coitus is?
Yeah. They call it under the Venn diagram.
You ever heard of coitus interruptus? You ever
is
heard
that
of that?
Called?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Coitus interruptus.
Don't look at me like
I
that, Bobby.
Okay? I hate
we
it.
Have another best.
It's the Jay Thomas Show.
Afternoons.
The Jay Thomas Show.
Are you kidding?
We were the hot new thing.
Jay Thomas.
Afternoons.
Indy Sirius XM 104.
Johnny came over and Jim did too, looking for a home cooked dinner. Mama in the kitchen said you never get through.
Another Grammy Award winner, Steve Martin on banjo and Edie Brickell singing a song that maybe four people give a shit about. All right, here we go. Yeah.
One day the preacher come to our door, said, something sure smells good. Father said, yes, and there's room for one more. Come and help yourself if you would.
It's a fun song.
Get along, get along, preacher.
Yeah, but it's like Prairie Home Companion. I like the show, but
Prairie Home Companion's a great show, and every once in a while I'll tune into it. I love it.
Yeah, I do,
and
too,
like, you know, Pete Seeger just died yesterday, and this is something that, you know, he preserved. You know, he preserved all of our folk music, and he cataloged it for many years before.
Now that he's dead, maybe nobody will play the fucking banjo anymore. Jesus Christ. How can you listen to this shit nothing at Deliverance? I love Steve Martin. He's great, but that banjo's got to go. That is like the hillbilly.
The banjo is a beautiful instrument, beautiful. And you know it, okay?
I can't
you know,
wait,
and
though.
Just for comedy purposes,
got,
you
got
just
some
like,
Oboros,
you know.
Got no teeth, they hate the Jews. Oh, shit, it's horrible.
They didn't say anything like that, you know? That, you've got mental problems, you really do.
I can't wait till hip-hop has the same notoriety as hillbilly or whatever the fuck this is.
Yeah. You awful.
Know, I don't know.
Bluegrass. Oh.
Yeah.
Wow. Very intricate, you know, the banjo.
Yeah. It's intricate, yeah, but it's, yeah, it's just annoying.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. It's for people that read books.
I'm gonna take up the banjo just to annoy Bobby.
It's for people that read books. What do you mean? It's for people who don't read books.
Yeah. Hold on a minute. Let's go around the horn. I have a round-the-horn question about the banjo. The banjo is the only instrument that was what? Christina, the banjo is the only instrument that was what?
The only instrument that was
what?
I don't know.
Christina, you're up.
Yeah, thanks, Garrett.
I know the answer.
The banjo. I'll come to you last.
Thank you.
No, not you.
Oh,
you're
why?
Still up because you're dumb. That's why.
You're up.
Well, that's proven.
All right. What is it?
The banjo is the only instrument that.
Time's up.
That'll be at the puppy bowl today.
Oh yeah, good idea.
No, Garrett. The banjo is the only instrument that what?
Was invented in America.
That's correct.
Oh. Okay, right.
That's correct?
Thank you. Yes, that's correct.
Yeah. Why? What were you going to say, Bobby?
Banned by Motown, Phil Spector, Philly's Records.
Kevin, what were you going to say?
I was going to say invented in America.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's the only instrument invented in America.
In the woods, ever. In Kentucky.
Yeah, that's right.
It's the only instrument to listen to when you're getting anally raped in the forest. It's the only thing. That's music to my ears. Nothing else. The Jew's harp?
That is so not true, but it is very funny that you say that. I admit that.
Google
it. It's true.
No, you're just trying to be funny. That's your whole character.
But,
you know?
The reason I'm funny is because truth is based on funny, funny things.
Yes, it is. It
true.
Is funny.
Just Google it. All right.
It's a fine instrument, and we congratulate Steve Martin for his.
Now, what is the top of the thing? What do you attach the strings to of a guitar or banjo? What are those things called up there at the top of
chords.
It?
The head and the pegs?
The head. The pegs.
That's
originally, pegs were just two or three teeth of a Kentucky guy, and the strings were dental floss. That's
well,
the
things
original.
Were different, you know. We've all moved right. on.
By the way, Jay it. Thomas Show at Gmail. Dear Jay, I live in Bonita Springs, Florida.
Ooh.
And you did a story earlier about a 79-year-old guy caught at a McDonald's parking lot masturbating while watching porn. I live near that McDonald's. His name is Spencer Toner, 79 years old.
Spencer
and
Toner.
He was viewing photographs on his laptop while waiting for his McRib sandwich to be cooked.
Oh, God.
Whoever said it before, I think you're right, though, because McDonald's has AT&T hotspots, which
yes.
are free.
Yeah,
you
right.
could go there and get mm-hmm. internet for free. Yeah, so that'd be yeah, what
Toner
it is.
Closed his laptop.
Block stuff like that.
He closed his laptop.
Yes, he closed
when
it.
When a deputy knocked on his window, and Toner's his pants were unbuttoned, and there was a white rag between his legs.
You remember that when you were up and the cops would bang on your window when you were making out with your girlfriend, like in the parking lot or something? Like, what are you doing in there? Nothing. I'm doing nothing.
One cop said through the window, pull your dress down, young lady. Oh, God. It was bad.
Yeah, they tell me that all the time. Pull your dress down, young man.
Toner said that the witnesses were invading his privacy when the cop told him to move along. Well, guess what? They booked his ass into jail. Why would you say that to the cop? You do whatever the cop says.
Yes, here's sir. Yes, sir. On my way.
She sings for the Nashville opera,
mm-hmm.
Amy Herbst. And her husband's in the Army, I guess. He's a staff sergeant. And they went into the hospital, and they gave her an episiotomy, which is where you cut that little piece of skin. So
yeah,
the
what
baby
is the episiotomy?
It opens up so the baby can come out easier. It's a little piece of skin.
Do you do this before you get pregnant?
No, it happens while you're in labor.
It happens while you're in labor.
When there's a whole lot of other things going on, then they're like, we've got to cut your vagina.
How do you know that?
Because I've done my research as to reasons why I don't want to have these little
things. Is that a cesarean section?
No, this is to cut because the baby can't fit through because of the shoulders.
And very funny.
And the head and all these parts.
And then they sew it. They sew it back.
Yeah, they sew you back.
And the doctor sometimes sews it back. Tighter, mm-hmm. so she'll have a tighter
Snoopy
vagina.
Snoopy says that she has that. Her vagina's okay. tighter.
And what's very funny, one of the top black baby names today, episiotomy. A lot of people don't know that. That's one of the top 10 in the last 10 years, episiotomy. People, Google it. Google it. Maybe. Very funny. And again, very true.
That is not true. That is a terrible thing to say. Okay,
you're going to think I'm lying. My buddy and I, he's a chef, and we used to go shopping and make
his name is episiotomy.
No, we were in the grocery store, and we were shopping the gay Safeway there in West Hollywood, and we're shopping away, and we heard a woman going, Poupon, Poupon, where are you? Calling her son, Poupon, all over the grocery store.
That's a nice name, Poupon.
It was a good one. So anyway, Miss Herbst was an opera singer, and now she's saying that when she sings certain high notes, her vagina flatulates. Uncontrollable. Mm-hmm.
It's not over till the front lady farts.
Is it just the vaginal parts, or is it her, farting, or is it just queefing?
Well, the flatulence would only come from her vagina because that's where the work was done.
Is that smell?
No. And by the way, the first time it ever happens is the worst time. Mm-hmm. Worst ever.
All right, turn it down. Let's listen. Let's listen.
This is her performance.
Yes. Yeah, this is her.
Uh-oh, that's it. And she was, You can't watch it. That's it. She's great, but, it's distracting.
I hate opera so much, I'd rather listen to the phone. I really hate opera.
What about a banjo?
She wants $2.5 million.
Yes.
Because her opera career ruined. Good. Let's go to Kevin of Atlanta. Yes, Kevin.
So sad.
What could you add to that sad?
That she would actually put out that story. That poor woman that had that done.
No, it's public notice suing.
Okay.
Yeah, Kevin, go ahead. Kevin of Atlanta.
Okay. Well, I think some of her better known arias might have been "Oh Smello." Wait a minute. Hang on. Madam Letterfly? How about John Diostinko? Right, the Farter of Seville? And my favorite, she'll be appearing off-Broadway in the new production of Beans, the musical fruit.
All right, let's hear it for Kevin of Atlanta. Wow.
Oh, now there's somebody who actually
he showed
called
up with
up
material.
With material.
Wow. Prepared.
Now
hold on a
call.
Minute. Now, Bobby or Kevin,
yes.
Would you ever do this bit on stage and use Kevin
great.
Of Atlanta, who can't use these jokes? Would you ever use these jokes on
Meany
stage?
Would. Bobby? I can ask them for both of us. No for me, yes for him. That's really all right. Yeah, come on. How well do you know me, Joe? You know I never knew such idiotic material.
Yes, you
and
would.
Meany would pay for it. He would
yes,
not only
would,
do it.
I would actually pay
just
for
it. Just get that
yes.
guy's number. He'll buy it.
You wouldn't do idiotic material. I would do that material.
I would do that in a minute.
You're not a comic, Jay. I mean, that's good
yes,
radio.
Yes, he is. He's a great comedian.
That's radio, good radio fodder. Farter, you get it? Good radio fodder. You see?
You did it again.
You know what? You're such a purist. You're just a purist.
No, he's just, he's in his little character, you know, and he's angry about
that's
gays
right.
and
yeah,
opera.
That's right.
Yeah.
Is this a character?
Probably doesn't manscape like me.
Kevin, very funny. Thank you
very much,
Kevin.
Thank you, Kevin.
Wow, he's very good.
He's very good.
These are always my favorite stories. A blind Wisconsin man who was getting $175,000 Social Security disability because he was completely blind, Lawrence Pop with two P's, was sentenced to 1 year in prison for fraud they sent out somebody from the Disability Social Security Administration and they saw him water skiing. Found him.
Well, what is wrong with that? You could water ski if you're blind.
Apparently, he didn't look blind.
He was reading the paper
while
he was water skiing.
They found him in the Cayman Islands.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. He had been a wealthy businessman. And he was also driving the ski boat. They have pictures of him driving a ski boat, a snowmobile, and driving a car to and from the benefits office. What an idiot.
Okay, that's a problem.
Wouldn't you think, Jay, before they give somebody benefits like that, they kind of make sure he's blind? Don't they do tests?
I don't know.
How would you give him a blind test, Bobby?
Well, I don't know. I'm not a doctor or a medical
examiner. Throw something at his head.
Okay, that's a good one. There you go. Yeah.
You know,
I think he went into the doctors and he pretended he was blind and he got all kind of letters and stuff. And so he's going to jail.
Remember Deborah Kerr? On the top of
the actress Deborah Carr. Deborah Carr
when she
was
hit,
spelled
K. She got hit by the car.
No.
And you know, with from here with Cary Grant on the top.
I know who she is, but she didn't. She got hit by a car, and what happened?
No, and she was blind in the movie.
Oh, in the movies. You know, that's something when you're a gay boy you watch. We didn't watch.
You think you get her name right, too.
I cried.
Deborah Carr. Actually, the reality is that when I was a kid, it's Carr. It's Deborah Carr. That's how she pronounced it.
Deborah Carr.
She was also in From Here to Eternity.
Oh, she was wonderful on that beach covered in sand. Sandpaper Annie.
As a kid, I would much rather watch a romantic movie or a comedy or whatever. And to this day, I have trouble with all the shooting and the blowing of shit up. I have never dug that because the star never gets hurt. And so even as a kid, I didn't like that the star didn't get hurt. Why? You get the shit beaten out of you. And, you know, nothing happens to you. You know, and you have a little bit of blood in your lip and everything else. I was hit in the head a few times. It hurts. You're down. It's over. Bingo. You know.
What about I, Frankenstein? Have you seen that?
Horrible, thank God.
I read something this morning about that. That
made
was
no
like,
money over the weekend.
Made one of the worst movies ever made.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
were you in that, Bobby?
I didn't see that. No,
you didn't see that?
No, it was not.
Brian of Philadelphia. Welcome to the Jay Thomas Show with the great Bobby Slayton
Bobby
in the studio
Slayton.
Along with Kevin Meany. Yeah. Yes, Brian of
great
Philadelphia.
Great Bobby Slayton and Kevin.
Yes.
Hello, Joe. Jay.
Yes.
Okay, you just said that the banjo is the only American instrument. I believe it's actually African.
What?
It's
the only instrument. It's the only instrument. The banjo, the way we know it with the circular bottom, is the only instrument that was invented in the United States. Period.
Well, we stole it from Africa.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's total bullshit to me. That's like saying the guitar was invented in the United States because we had.
Hold on a minute.
The guitar was.
Excuse me. Hold on 1 second. Brian, go online, type in the banjo, and it says it right there. You know, calling me up and saying you don't believe it with absolutely no fucking information. Get rid of this asshole. Get completely rid of him.
Oh.
It was fashioned by Africans living in colonial America.
Thank you.
Yes.
All right, so he was probably right.
No, he wasn't.
It was made
in the United States.
Africa,
they saw instruments in Africa that were like banjos.
And
they were banjos.
Yeah.
No, they weren't.
They were.
There's no banjo in Africa.
There was.
Have you ever seen one of those cannibal movies where somebody played a banjo?
Mm-hmm.
No, never.
But in those cannibal movies, if a guy did play banjo, I could see why you would eat him. That I understand. I'd eat him.
When I was a kid, cannibal movies scared me. But let me tell you what. I was so scared of pygmies when I was a kid.
Oh, God.
Tarzan was always getting attacked by pygmies. Oh, they were vicious. The cannibals, there were cannibals in Africa, but where the cannibals were the Hawaiian Islands and Fiji and those islands. They were horrible cannibals.
Daniel, in a way, he was a cannibal.
They were horrible cannibals opposed to the good ones. They were the good cannibals and horrible cannibals.
They didn't turn it around until like in the early 1900s. And, you know, they ate a couple of missionaries.
Yeah. What's the joke, Kevin? They never ate comedians. You know why they don't eat comedians?
Mm-mm.
They taste funny. Good night, ladies and gentlemen. Media will use that one. That's me. You can have that one, too.
Prince.
A one-man show for you tonight.
Prince has found 22 internet users, like my kids or you guys or whatever, who have sent bootleg copies of his concerts or his music to others.
Uh-oh.
He's got their names. He is suing them for $1 million apiece, and I am so fucking happy.
Yeah,
they have got to fucking stop. And I say to
my
kid,
he was up at Mohegan Sun the same night I was there. He was in the big room. I was in the smaller cabaret.
Absolutely. Sue the shit out of them and just keep going. And, you know, my kids, I'm nervous as hell. I tell them, you know, stop it. It's theft. Don't do it.
They steal things from the internet?
Yeah, hell
yeah. What are they stealing?
Buy some for 99 cents and you send it out to your friends.
Oh, don't.
You know, what about bootleg records and CDs? You have a problem with that, Jay?
Yes, I do. Absolutely.
Really?
Stealing things?
Like my son's a musician. He would have been a multimillionaire 20 years ago. He probably makes hundreds of thousands. But he says, look, what can I do? We write songs, they get on the internet, and they're gone. They're people download.
Well, Jay, don't you have any favorite bands you love from the old days? Beatles, Stones, Dylan, Zeppelin? And wouldn't love a great bootleg tape of some of the concerts that hasn't been released?
No.
Really?
I'll pay for it.
Jay thinks bootleg means a stolen copy. But bootleg means like you were at the concert and you filmed it, and then you're selling that recording.
Why are you
it could be either
that?
One, Garrett. Garrett, it could be either one. If you buy something for 99 cents or a dollar or whatever, the $2, and you send it on, that's theft. That's theft.
But what if you went to a concert and recorded it on, you know?
That is wrong. They tell you before the concert that there'll be no recording.
No picture.
Turn off your
Everyone
recorders.
Loves those.
Well, they're against the law.
Jeff has sent me at jthomasshow@gmail.com. Jay, I was curious, you were a sports announcer. Did you ever announce the Shrine football game, which used to be like a Senior Bowl kind of a thing?
That was from the Burn Victims.
When you lived in Charlotte, I played in one in the late 70s. No, I did high school football in Jacksonville, and I did Division I basketball for the University of North Carolina at Charlotte for 2 years. Back in those days, I never did college football, and I had a decision to make. Either I was going to be a disc jockey and an actor and a comedian or whatever, or I was going to be a sports announcer. And I made but when I first got to New York, I was the sideline reporter for the Jets, even though I wasn't on the air. I sent the injury reports from the visitor side, Garrett, back up to the announcers, up in the booth.
Wow.
And I was on the sidelines with the Washington Redskins. If we look back to the year, like 1978, I was on the sideline. I did it for 2 years, I think, 77 and 78. I was on the sidelines for the Jets those 2 years, and I would be sending the injury reports back. I got to stand next to the head coach, and I was all hooked up with headphones, and I had an orange jacket on and everything else. But I also had some Jets paraphernalia that they gave me. I had to wear this Jets thing. And I had a thing around my neck that had my picture and all, and it had Jets on it, right? So George Allen is the coach. I've never told you this. It was the coach of the Washington Redskins. It was a very tight game. Mm-hmm. Maybe Joe Namath was, maybe it was one of his last games. And so it was a really tight game. And when somebody would go down, I would say, it looks like so-and-so's knee is hurt, you know, whatever the linebacker's name was, and I would send it up. So I'm talking into this microphone. George Allen, the coach of the Redskins, turns to me and says to one of his assistants, he's telling him what we're calling. That's what he said. And I go, what? Get him out of here. He's a spy, I swear to God. And it was like Richard Nixon, you know, it was like nuts. So they moved, yeah. Because I was talking at the same time, he had the quarterback, whoever was there, and he was going, look, I want you to run a zig right, you know, 22 jig up and down or whatever. And I'm going, it looks like the guy's right leg is hurt or whatever.
Yeah, you're right behind him whispering.
Right behind him with the microphone, screaming and yelling. So here's the other thing. Joe Namath plays his last game. I don't know what year it was.
With the Rams?
So I
Jets?
Go 72.
Oh, God.
I would No. Later than that.
75?
I wasn't in radio in 72. I mean, I was in college down south. So I go over to the Jets side at halftime, and Namath takes off his raincoat, his big green Jets raincoat, and he puts it on the bench. And I carried this big bag with me, and I would steal NFL balls every now and again. And so it's halftime. So I'm throwing the football on the sidelines and all of that, waiting for the halftime to be over. And there was Namath's raincoat. And it had Namath inside of it. And it fit his helmet and his shoulder pads. So the game ensues, and it was the final game. And everybody leaves, and I take my headphones off, and I cross the field. And there at the end of the bench is Joe Namath's raincoat right next to my bag, right next to it. And so I just took it, and I stuffed it in my bag, and I took it home.
Oh, my God, really?
I know. I kept that thing for years, but they didn't have what we have now. You know how expensive things are. And who knows what that would be worth, right? And somewhere along the line, I probably gave it to Goodwill or something like that. But I had this Joe Namath Jets raincoat with his name inside of it for years and years. And these old NFL balls, the Duke, you know,
the Duke
Jets on the side of them and all that. Yeah, I was. So I guess maybe I'm a thief, too, like the people that are stealing from Prince. I don't know.
So he didn't wear the fur coat all the time? Or is that a thing?
No, it was during the game. It was raining. He wore a big giant. You know, he didn't wear the fur coat on the sidelines unless he was hurt. But, all kind of stuff would happen. Oh, and I remember that Joe Theismann and I were about the same size, and he wasn't a starter yet.
Joe Theismann?
And I just, whatever, Theismann. Whatever size he was, I couldn't believe it. So we're on the sidelines, and he wasn't a starter. He had played at Miami, and they brought him over, and he was returning kicks or whatever. So I get to talking to him on the sidelines, and I said, God, you're not very big, are you? He goes, yeah, I'm not very big, but you look like a fucking parking lot attendant with that orange outfit on. That's so we had a lot of fun.
Wow.
We put each other down. Yeah, he was funny. I couldn't believe years later he became a premier quarterback. He was literally 5'10", maybe 5'10". Hard to believe.
And then years after that, he became I pee my pants spokesman.
He's an IP your pants spokesman?
Yeah, he sells these pills that apparently helps you hold it, your bladder, throughout the football game or something.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Really?
Why would you that? That's not healthy.
Bobby, did you ever date a woman years ago that went to Est and you'd have to go for 12 hours to these meetings?
No, but I almost did, and
yeah, we all did. We all almost did. Yeah,
I never got into that.
But you know, they're back again with a new name called Landmark Forum. which is the same kind of thing. It's not called EST anymore.
What does that stand for?
Earhart, someone or training, Werner Earhart. And he, you know, they did these trainings where, and I don't know if this is the exact same thing, but there are people trying to get me into this, and it's a whole weekend. You pay $500. You're there Friday through Sunday, like 18 hours a day. They interrogate you. They call you.
Maybe you could teach the course. Both of us could.
Everybody I know that's done it says it's changed their life. They're better people. And, but I'd like to go just because I know that's not going to happen. I don't want to be a
Well, I had a beautiful girlfriend, and she was into everything. And I knew her from North Carolina. She was a model. It took me years to get her away from her boyfriend, Jim Skidmore. And so I get her away from Jim. I start dating her. Mary was her name. I was crazy about her. And she did all of this, you know, model, you know, therapy and all this kind of stuff. And so she is going to EST. And we're dating, and so she takes me to EST, and they wouldn't let you leave to pee. And they would sell these things that you put on your dick, and I think it was in a, I think Burt Reynolds did it in a movie too, where the wire ran down your leg, and it went into a plastic bottle. And I pee all the time, always have. So I wore one of those for, I never peed. But I wore one of those and sat through one day of that shit. And I have no idea. What's it called now? Is that that guy, the same guy from EST?
He's dead. That guy's dead.
Yeah.
Earhart?
Yeah. But those things are old.
What's his name?
Where you wear those.
Earhart?
Werner Earhart.
Werner Earhart.
Not the guy, I should not wear one of those at night. I hate that's getting Amelia. Up at night. Peeing. I'd love to just pee down my leg. Just piss in
you
the bed.
You could wear a leg bag.
A diaper.
It would keep it
let's go to
Janine
in Long Island. Yes, Janine of Long Island. Hi.
Jay. Hi, Jay. Love your show. Love you. And I wanted to, well, two things. Philomena, the movie. Amazing movie.
Yes.
To see.
Now, wait. You know what? That's not a true story.
Part of it is.
Yeah, part of it is. And they say it's true. She and the guy never came to the United States together. She had given her son up or whatever. They'd taken the child away from her. And so what's the use of going to a movie that I know is heart-wrenching about a woman having her baby taken away from her by the nuns and all that stuff? And yet...
Did they take the baby away from her?
Yeah, he was raised in the United States, and he looked for his mother his whole life. But in the movie... they have a guy that goes to the United States with her or something. Does she meet her son in the movie? Does she speak to her son?
He died. Oh, sorry, I gave it away. But
No. She dies. She died. You know what? Hold on a minute. If you don't read about movies before you go to see it, no, I think it's perfectly fine. You can't ruin the movie for me. You couldn't ruin it for me.
It brings out the thousands of babies that were taken from the woman and sold.
Yes.
And it
by the Catholic Church.
That's
by the Catholic Church.
That's right. Do is right. So now talking about Prince, I'd like to say that I just saw a show on Sunday morning. The Grateful Dead, which has a net worth of over $30 million, made their money by asking their fans to tape their music and share it. That's how they only
The Grateful
had
Dead is worth more than $30 million.
Well, they only had one number one hit, Touch of Grey.
Right.
All the rest was from sharing their music. I disagree with Prince, and he should be ashamed of himself going after
really?
People that support him. Absolutely. It's the World Wide Web now. It's social media.
No. By the way, if you try to tape one of our shows, anybody's show on these channels,
we're gonna
or Howard
see
or anyone, and if you put it on any other radio station or you started playing it in a restaurant or something, SiriusXM would sue you so fast, it'd make you friggin'
Well, that's why there's ASCAP and BMI.
I download Opie and Anthony illegally from the internet every day.
You do?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, Howard Stern Garrett, if I want you show. To turn yourself
wow.
in
I will.
To the
Prince
president
is not
after
busy
the
enough.
Show.
Prince
you,
is not busy
You can
enough.
Listen to Howard Stern on the internet?
You could download it, yeah.
People post it.
I love Jay Tom. I love your show. You're my afternoon cup of coffee every day. I'm here on Long Island.
Don't you sell one thing you hear here.
Can we put Jay Thomas's show upload it?
Some people do.
Yeah, good.
There are sites where I sell up there.
Just one
online. I'll come at you with the full force of the United States.
I bet Bobby puts it up this afternoon.
Come and get me. Come and get me.
Janine, thank you very much.
All
thank
right,
you.
Take care.
Let's stay in Long Island. Rick is in Long Island. Yes, Rick, go ahead.
Hey, Jay, love your show. Oh, by the way, we have a mutual friend named Jill in New York, and she took you once to see me perform in the East Village at a club called New Blue. Do you remember that?
You know who that is, Garrett? That's Jill Coxhead.
Do you know her? Yeah.
Very well. Yeah, remember Jill? Yeah. That's her last name. Her last name is Coxhead.
Excellent.
And
I have
her brother and her father are so proud of their name, and she was Madison's roommate. I do know Jill. And her brother is Bill Coxhead, and her dad is Bill Coxhead Sr. But Jill got married to a guy. His last name was Simon, so she took his last name. And she said in high school, she's really beautiful. Jill Coxhead. Yeah, I know her. She's very nice. She used to do the show here. She, Garrett, didn't she fill in a couple of times for Madison? Or
she definitely here a few times.
Yeah, she was around. Yeah. Well, I went to see you perform musically somewhere.
Yeah, in the East Village.
I remember that. I do remember it. Yes.
Yeah.
Well, good to hear from you. Go ahead.
Yeah,
I remember you. Well, I don't remember what you look like, but I.
Well, I wanted to say I had a nice Joe Namath story. Back in the 70s when they used to practice right near the main road, Hempstead Turnpike, at Hofstra University, my dad used to take me there when I was very little, and you could basically pull over on the side of the road by the Nassau Coliseum, get out of your car, go to the fence, and Joe Namath would eventually just come over to the fence and shake your hand and sign an autograph.
He was a very nice guy. Nice. What's sad about Joe is, well, the drinking thing when he tried to kiss the sideline reporter. But he's a terrible announcer, and they have him on some games or whatever. Yeah. But he could never announce the game. And
not a great actor either.
You know,
and he did musicals. He did musicals.
Yes.
Yeah, he sure did. Yes.
Jay, were you ever a part of 99X on FM?
Yeah, I worked at 99. I was the morning disc jockey at 99X.
Ah, yes. You see, I knew you. That was my favorite station when I was very young.
What do you do now, Rick? We've seen you.
I'm a musician. I'm a professional musician. I write music. I student privately, and I compose. So I'm always doing music and art. You know. But I remember from then, you know?
Well, thank you.
You're awesome.
Bobby Slayton, you're a comic. Were you athletic as a child? Did you play any sports?
You know, Jay, I think that, you know what?
He's a good swimmer.
You're very thin.
You know what? It's funny. I was never been a good athlete, but I became better as an adult. I don't know.
Yes.
I've always been good with the solo sports.
Isn't that interesting, though? Like, you know, like you're in great shape. And all these guys that were in high school, you know, that were, you know, they can hardly walk now.
Every guy I know sports. Who is a high school athlete, and you know, well, Jay, you were an athlete. You have bad knees, bad neck, bad shoulders,
all of it,
bad of it, right? Did. Right, a lot of it, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's hard for you to work out now. I mean, look, I would
no,
but Jay's
I have to
in,
tell you,
Jay's
you
in know, really good shape though.
No, he's
I'm
in great
really
shape.
Good shape.
But
you're
hurting.
I'll tell you what.
You're hurting though, right? Over the years.
Yeah, but you know what? I was in a very I would be protected. And so I played on teams where I had a lot of protection. So I was lucky. But in the games that I get beat up, and I have pictures of these games where these guys were hitting me, I've seen the films. My body, it bent and bowed, and my head was slapped to the ground.
It's like a boxer. You take blows.
But I played on really, I had a great line. I played for this community college at the end of my career. And then even when I played, thank you, Rick, very much. We're done.
Hey, I'll talk to you guys later.
All right, great talking to you. Thanks. Thanks a lot. Let's move in together. But the thing is that those guys that got hit all the time, I mean, even, you know, in the small time football that I played, I guess they got hurt too. I don't know. Their heads are all. I mean, getting hit. You know.
Yep.
I mean, it's.
Yeah,
it's bad. You know?
I was not an athlete.
But I boxed, but I didn't box long. I got the shit beaten out of me.
But Bobby, you work out, right?
Yeah, but I was never a I was never an athlete. I was when they picked all the kids for kickball. You know, I got picked before the retarded kid, the fat kid, and then there was like, mm-hmm. you know, I wasn't very good. You know, I like to play. I love to play.
But you went, we went swimming together when we were in Mexico.
You and I swam together in Mexico.
We did.
But you know what? I didn't want to do the synchronized swimming like you did. I was trying to do laps, mm-hmm. and you tried to do the whole Esther Williams thing, and you know, and then I'm, and they go. And with the whole mermaid, with the thing they had on your feet, and, you know, the sparkles. And I'm going, you listen.
Did he wear a hat? Did he wear a little
He's doing another character. You know, here I was in my Speedo, and yeah. I had my goggles and my earplugs on, and I was doing laps, and he couldn't keep up with me.
Okay.
You couldn't.
And you didn't know you were gay. That's amazing.
No, this was just a couple of months ago.
That's what I mean.
Yeah.
Nick writes, I tuned into your show toward the end of it. You were on the phone with Colin Quinn, and you ended by saying, I can't wait to see Colin Quinn masturbating on girls. I had just tuned in. I had no idea what the context of that line was. I'm sure it had to be a callback to something earlier.
Yes.
I have no idea, but I began laughing so much at this non sequitur that I became completely red in the face. What could you possibly have been talking about? He's on the TV show Girls, and he said that has a scene where he's in his office masturbating. And I said, I can't wait to see you masturbating on Girls, meaning the TV show.
They should have him masturbating in his car at McDonald's.
No, he's in the back. He's in his office. This is from Errol. You really put down Led Zeppelin yesterday.
Yeah.
First of all, Led Zeppelin didn't steal all or most of their songs like you would have people believe. They gave credit to most of the songs they covered. They were sued for about five of their songs that they didn't give credit to. Every rock band has stolen from someone in their career.
Really?
Listen to the archaic blues songs and try and make as good as a rock song as Led Zeppelin ever did. The original songs.
This is a really big Led Zeppelin
fan. That's a big, yeah. Third, why not talk about all the other bands who stole songs? Okay?
People have so much time on their hands that they can actually write this out.
Hey, Errol, you're a fan of fucking thieves, okay? Robert Plant. And who's the other asshole, Garrett? Who's the other
Jimmy one? Page.
Jimmy Page. So, Errol, enjoy that you like fucking thieves, okay? And why don't you add Michael Bolton to that, another fucking thief.
Really?
Another long-haired, ask the Isley Brothers, another long-haired fucking thief.
You really hate thieves.
I hate them.
You sure do?
You're exactly correct. I fucking hate them. I mean...
Except for that little boy with Joe Namath's raincoat. You don't hate that little
Bobby kid. Slayton called me out as a thief in 1980.
I did?
Those
balls were used.
What do you see?
I stole a joke from George Carlin.
Oh, okay.
And you said
Bobby called you up.
Yeah. This is like my first started in San Francisco at the other cafe. And he comes up and he goes, where'd you get that joke? Where'd you get that joke? And I said, what joke? What joke are you talking about? I know what joke you took. You took that joke.
What was it?
What was the joke?
The joke was, how come you can never get laid on Thanksgiving? Because all the coats are on the bed. And you go, that's George Collins' joke. And it was. I had stolen it from him.
Yeah. And that's when you turned gay. That was the same day.
And I said, God, you know what, I can't believe it. Yeah. But I had just started. I had just, you know, like I was.
I didn't know you when I was trying to be a comic.
Right.
But it's guys like you that stopped me from going any further.
Thank God.
So serious. They were so uptight.
Oh, really? You're bitching about Led Zeppelin, but we couldn't attack you. Thief, we hate you. It's okay. He's going on and on. Look at you, on and on by Michael Ball. On and on.
Well, it was an open mic night. I mean, I was just starting out.
Yes,
so
I'm with you. I stole from Bill Cosby. I stole from Woody Allen. I put my own stuff in there before there was the internet. Everybody knew all their material.
Right. Yeah.
I was trying to figure shit out.
I listened to that Lenny Bruce bit, The Genie in the Bottle. You remember that one?
Look, I probably did it too, you know? And if that,
oh, really? Now you're coming clean.
I said probably. What did you say? Probably. No, but comics, I think when you start out like musicians, either subliminally or you take licks, I mean, it's until you evolve into You know, I don't think I out and out took comedy routines like Kevin Meaney or you. I wasn't an out and out thief. I shot, maybe I shoplifted a tad like Oliver because I was hungry. I wanted a roll. You know, it was for the own good. Or maybe like Robin Hood, I stole from the rich and gave to the poor.
Right.
Maybe
like,
I did it with good intention.
Like late as a rob. Thief, like you needed to feed your family. You needed to feed your family.
Yes, so exactly.
Like more like late
no, no.
Rob.
But there were times, and every comic's done it subliminally, or you're a yeah. young comic, and you're in a bind, and you got to get out of something, but some people just keep going.
Are you tweeting these thoughts?
No, I'm telling you.
I know, but do you tweet?
I tweet a little.
No. Yeah.
If you had a pitbull of comedy, I tweet, and every time I say something that
no,
I think
should
funny.
Be Bobby Slayton. It shouldn't be this pitbull. You should drop the pitbull.
I know, but say, you yeah. know what? Somebody started my account for me years ago, and I'm going to change put it back to Bobby.
It should
Slayton.
Be Bobby Slayton. Yeah. This pitbull thing, nobody likes pitbulls, all right? They don't like them.
Well, I mean it. I mean,
well, if I put Bobby Slayton, nobody likes me either. It doesn't really make
they
any
like
difference.
You. You are the most charming man. You're so funny.
Really?
And he charming. Is. He is very charming. He really is.
He just
I have a little crush on
greatest,
him. I do.
Greatest
I have a little
cunt
crush
in
on
the world.
Him.
He just did the whole cunt bit about 30 minutes ago.
I was a charming bit, Jay.
Yeah, that is charming.
You look at it the surface. You look at it on the surface level. But if you dig deep, Jay, you listen to like a song. Sometimes it's more meaning uh-huh. than you're willing to dig. You just get yeah. lazy. That's all.
Tens of thousands of people watched in St. Peter's Square as our Pope, Pope Francis, who was a Jesuit, and quite an interesting Pope he is, was speaking about peace, and then he releases two doves of peace.
Oh.
They were immediately attacked by a seagull and a large black crow, and they were pecked to death.
No, they got away. They got away. The doves got away.
One dove, wait a minute, one dove broke free from the gull, but the crow was seen repeatedly pecking the other dove
the
into
devil.
Submission.
Fucking blacks.
Yeah. Yeah, it
nothing but trouble.
It was bad.
Nothing but trouble. Get the little white guy.
Poor little dove.
That was bad.
And what did the
that
Pope say? Really oh, that's so sad.
Well, he looked away. He had to look away. By the way, Roger Goodell says he may let pot be smoked by NFL players.
The Pope went like this.
Oh no! But you know what? That's a good idea.
We all should.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Yeah,
you know. I mean, really.
It's going to be legalized, you know.
Yeah, and in Seattle, a guy lives in Seattle or he plays for Denver. Mm-hmm. They test his pee. It's legal. And you get thrown off the team. Now there's a
it's
lawsuit.
It's going to be a little
there.
Problem. Yeah, it's legal.
Absolutely. Right, Garrett? I mean, that's true, isn't it? I mean, I think Jersey's trying to get it. If you get medical marijuana,
Jersey, you can
your...
gamble now. If you live in Jersey, you can gamble online. Legally.
No, you can't.
Yes, you can.
Really?
Yeah.
It's kind of hard. You have to prove you are in New Jersey.
I know, but like, what if you're on the border? I mean, like, they have these great commercials here,
Jay. How about if I just
have
a picture of trash behind me?
And they have these commercials now on radio. You're driving around New York, and they're talking about, you know, you can gamble online. Gambling online is lots of fun if you're in New Jersey. You know, it's like it's like this big gambling song. You can gamble online and lose your fucking house and everything. It's great. I thought I'd just pass that on.
Gary, who is in New Jersey, have you gambled online yet, Gary of New Jersey?
No, I have not gambled online, Jay.
How come?
Thank you for asking. Because I have better things to do with my money. I pay for Sirius Satellite Radio, and
that's $14 a month for
that's
price.
More than it's, well, every 2 months.
What a bunch
pay
of
every month.
You know what?
I paid the one price 100 years ago, and I'm still.
Well, there you go.
You still have
you
that radio?
It
only works for the radio you buy it with, right?
That's right, but I listen online, and my online subscriptions.
There you go.
He made a great deal.
Wow.
This
I've
guy.
Never a bunch of cheapskates, subscribe to this play. Always bitching about the money. Are you kidding?
I love my service. I enjoy it.
So, Gary, what made you just stop? What were you doing when you decided to call?
I'm doing paperwork, Jay. I process paper for a living, and that's how I make my money. I'm listening to you. I'm enjoying the show. You got comics there. I thought I would try to call with something funny. I always try to contribute to the show.
Sure.
Well, we appreciate that.
Well, go ahead.
Okay. My first friend, and these are true. First friend on Facebook was my, high school girlfriend, the girl who took my virginity. And what do I find out? never married, no children. Mm-hmm. A couple of weeks ago, I'm on a charity thing, and I see a girlfriend from, like, when I'm in my 20s. True story. She holds up both of her hands, and she shows me her hands. She goes, never married, no children. So I told my wife, and I go, you're the lucky one. You have the house, the children, you got everything. You're the lucky one. She goes, I never wanted these children. They hate me. They treat me like shit. Oh. Fuck you. I'm going shopping.
This is your big bit that you decided to call with Bobby Slayton and Kevin Meaney and me.
You could open up for Bobby.
Get rid of this fucking guy and never call back, you fucking talentless asshole. Jesus Christ.
Sometimes it's all in your head. You really think it's going to work.
Who tells the boring that they're interesting? I don't fucking get it.
Who tells them, Meaney? Huh?
Who tells them?
Who tells you?
I know. It's amazing.
You are so right. You are so right.
The most boring people call up radio shows, think they know about politics, think they know about sports. You know,
or even telling a story.
I was listening to the NBA channel before I came on. It was running in my studio, and the announcer, I could hear him on break. Don't want to say what his name is. Somebody says something, goes, well, you know, they're going to be asking me the same stupid fucking dumb questions they ask every day, like that, about his listeners. And sure enough, they come back on the air, and some guy goes, hey, man, Knicks made $130 million. How come they don't win any games? All right? And I'm sitting in my chair going, what a dumb fucking question, you know. And then the poor announcer guy has to put up with that shit. Jesus Christ.
You should listen to the Diary of a Dominatrix.
Or how about, no, my favorite show, Slant. No, Slant.
Slant with Agent.
Yeah, I'm going to watch Slant, and what's Bobby's show, Gook Was Taken.
Right? Yeah, Gook Was Taken. But I want to see Fruit Juice with Kevin Meaney. Yes. Get a load of me. Get a load
By the
on
way,
Fruit Juice.
For those of you that Meaney. just tuned in, it's a callback to the new Vivid channel. Yeah. The new Vivid channel.
First guest. Yeah.
Jason of North Carolina. Yes, go ahead.
Great to be on Fruit Juice.
I gamble online from North Carolina. I've never heard Kevin's commercial.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you can gamble online, but I think pretty much from anywhere.
No, you can't. They're
not into New Jersey. You must be gambling online into South America.
Yeah, or gambling some... I don't know. Can
you gamble online?
You can gamble on sports. They have table games. You can play blackjack. You can play all sorts of shit.
Really?
And do they pay
absolutely.
You real money? Real money?
Yeah.
Well, you must be. You're not going to Jersey. You're going to South America.
Or like some island, you know.
Yeah, it's probably. Yeah. I think it's actually like the Virgin Islands or
the
something.
The Virgin. Dirty,
you know, I used
islands.
To bet. I
That's
used to
the
bet
Virgin
football.
Islands is America.
I bet football online a few years back. And then, I think they owed me some money or I got my money back or whatever. They closed the site down and said it couldn't work in the United States, and those guys just stiffed everybody on their money.
Oh, my God.
But, there's $1 billion. We used to advertise offshore stuff. They don't allow that anymore. Not at all. Mm-hmm. Golden what, Garrett? Golden
Palace. Golden Showers?
Golden Palace.
Palace. I'm sorry. What was I thinking?
All right. Thank you, Jason. Bobby Slayton is back in New York. He'll be in Kansas City very soon.
Oh, tomorrow I'm going there.
Now, do they fly you? Do they pay for your flight? And
yeah, you work with the same people all the time?
No, I work with different people. Kevin, you know shit how Stanford works. Yeah, I'm going to the Stanford and Sons, which will be a fine
I thought they closed
club.
Down.
They moved.
So is he out of jail now, the guy that ran Stanford?
You know, Bobby, this isn't the best advertisement the way you're...
Well, it's a great club.
Yeah, it's a great club. I've been out there.
You know what it is, Jed?
I'm excited to be there.
You know what it is? I love Kansas City. Great barbecue, great club. It's great. I go to the Johnny Dale radio show in the morning. It's great. But you know what, though? After spending a week in New York, and even though it's freezing here, you know what? I just went out. I went to Brooklyn yesterday. I took a subway out there to go to a couple of pizza places, and I went by. Yeah. I saw a couple old friends, and then I just got there's so much to
picked
do.
Picked up some blow.
Well, I think that goes without saying.
So let's say you were offered a job at that radio show in Kansas City.
Yeah.
He would do it in a minute.
A couple hundred grand a year, and you do the morning show. Right. And, would you and your wife move to Kansas City?
Yes, you would.
No, I would.
Really?
Oh, you would.
For 200 grand solid money every week.
Yes.
$4,000 a week.
Well, I'm already kind of making that doing stand-up. And I don't have to be in Kansas City all the time.
But you don't have to travel then.
Hey, I wouldn't have to travel. But the thing is...
How does that make you feel?
Okay, I like Kansas City, but when you live there, you want to travel.
Now, is it Kevin, the Kansas City?
I would go for 200 these days. I'd go over there.
Right now, you know what? I'm so sick of traveling. I'm going to play so many crappy comedy clubs. Not this one this weekend, and certainly not the Grey Improv next week.
No, Kansas City's beautiful. I love going to Kansas City.
You know what,
Bobby?
You got to do what my wife says.
Everything's up to date in Kansas City.
Every place you play is great, and don't have people guessing what you're saying is not great. I mean,
No, Kansas City is great. I don't know if I'd live there is what I'm saying.
All right.
You know, I mean,
I would move there.
Look, I lived in Vegas 2 years. I love Vegas. I don't think I can live there again. Chicago, I love. I maybe live there. Seattle, I love. Maybe. But New York and
LA. Would your wife move to New York and you'd live in a little apartment?
No, that's all the more reason I'd love to live here. I love New York. She would never move here. It's
why wouldn't she move here?
She's a cunt. We knew that.
We already reviewed that in the beginning of the program.
My wife, this cold, would really.
Hey, Garrett, another callback.
No, you know what it is? I live here, but you really need a lot of money to live in this town. You know that.
That's right.
Yeah.
You need money. Not if you live in a hovel like me.
Bobby, if you sold your house in California.
I could live here.
No more taxes.
Yeah.
You would pay rent, you know, $3,000 a month would get you a really nice place. You can live in, $3,000? Don't you pay three grand, Garrett?
Where?
In New York City?
I do, but because we've been living there for 12 years.
Oh, in Brooklyn, $3,000?
Yeah, like my apartment would go for probably like $3,500.
Well, that's not a lot.
Okay, $500
more. A one-bedroom kind of thing, not like...
Really?
Yeah, everything's really.
Jay, I would love to live where you're living. I could live in Santa Barbara.
You know what you wouldn't like? You wouldn't like people hate driving in L.A. I don't give a shit, but I love it.
So. What's that,
Bobby? BobbySlayton.com. That's the end of the show.
Oh, it is.
And Bobby, thanks. Yeah, anytime you want to come on, you were wonderful today.
He's the
best.
I love Bobby.
I love you too, Kevin. In a way.
And Kevin Meaney.
I know you really do love me, Bobby.
Find out about Kevin.
You just put on a big act.
Christina's going to the Puppy Bowl.
Puppy Bowl.
And she's in the city. She sets up children's parties. So contact Christina to do that.
Korean restaurant.
Girls watch.
It's what's played against the Super Bowl.
Mm-hmm.
It's puppies playing football. It's been on for years. Sponsored by a beer company.
So much fun! I love it.
With Animal Planet.
Garrett Andrews is going home to cook for his girlfriend. I'm going to do everything I can not to play golf. That's the biggest problem I have in the next 5 minutes. All right, we'll do this again tomorrow.
Let's go get home.